7-6.
I'd like to call the Beaufort County Board of Commissioners February board meeting to order. And at this time, I'll ask Commissioner Langley to do the invocation and Commissioner Evans to do the pledge.
Let us pray. Oh Lord our God, we are grateful and thankful for the opportunity to assemble ourselves together on this evening. Father, we just simply pray that you will order our steps and direct our hearts and minds to do what's best for your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please join us in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
At this time, I will ask if anybody has a conflict of interest that they would like to disclose before the meeting is started.
I'm not going to be voting on the offer to sell or purchase or whatever it is on GAE of a county property, GAE, whatever it's called.
Okay. Anyone else? All right. Item number D, the approval of the agenda. One request that I've had is to move item number 7 up to number 1 under items for discussion. Since we have a couple people here from the Committee 100 that will be available to answer any questions the commissioners may have. Items for decision, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Move item number 7 up to number 1.
What about the resolution for Martin County on upgrading 17?
That's under the consent, if I remember.
Is that under consent?
Yes.
Oh, is it? Okay. I don't remember it being under consent.
It's under consent. Okay, any other comment on the agenda? If not, can I have a motion to approve the agenda?
So may.
I'll second.
Got a motion by Commissioner Buzzio and a second by Commissioner Langley. All those in favor, raise your right hand. Unanimous. Okay, we're down to the public comments, and we have Mr. Ray Leary.
Good afternoon. My name is Ray Leary, representing the Citizens for Better Government. Commissioners. Beaufort County EMS, a rollout of countywide paramedic level service has not been friendly to taxpayers. A few points. White Oak EMS service in the eastern end of Beaufort County was terminated by White Oak because, as we understand, the county failed to work out an agreement that all could live with, much as we're seeing with the city of Washington. Beaufort County served notice to Chalkawinity EMS their contract would not be renewed. Further negotiations with Chalkawinity EMS were contentious because Chalkawinity desired to provide non-emergency medical transport services to facilities outside of Beaufort County. Chalkawinity and the county eventually reached an agreement to continue to provide EMS service. Chalkawinity EMS came back to the board requesting a franchise for non-emergency transport, proclaiming that without such an arrangement, the EMS and Chalkawinity could not survive financially. The board advanced to Chalkawinity the contracted EMS tax revenue and a franchise for non-emergency services, which they were asking for 6 months. The county has taken the responsibility of providing EMS to the eastern end of Beaufort County and purchased 2 ambulances from White Oak. The county then floated a plan to take over all EMS service based on a consultant's recommendation, including the city of Washington, which would allow for centralized billing. A joint committee was established to work on this. The city of Washington and Beaufort County have been in joint discussions for several months over how to best provide EMS service to Washington Township, which the city has been providing under contract to the county. This impasse continues as we speak with no acceptable resolution on the table, although I do see something on the agenda for it tonight. Both parties do agree that if the city stops providing EMS to Washington Township, both parties will suffer financially. There is no data available to this board suggesting countywide paramedic level service has now or will in the future improve emergency medical care in Beaufort County. There are, however, studies by the World Health Organization that reviewed the literature and found no conclusive benefit to paramedic service. Ad valorem taxes were increased in 2016 3.8%. The solid waste fee was increased 61%. The water rates were increased 3%, and the EMS taxes were increased in some districts. Even with this tax and fee increases, the general fund was tapped to balance the 16-17 budget, as it was with the 15-16 budget. Beaufort County continues to be ranked by the North Carolina Department of Commerce as a Tier 1 county. The taxpayers in Beaufort County need relief, and one place to start is using data to formulate delivery of EMS. Continuation budgeting can serve only to increase the spending in the 17-18 budget. The EMS cost curve is headed in the wrong direction. The citizens of Beaufort County have no voice in the level of EMS provided. This whole mess was created by this board. It is time to ask the voters and taxpayers what they desire and how much they are willing to pay for what they desire. Thank you.
Okay, now we come down to item number F, the approval of the items for consent.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Before you get into that, the clerk has advised me that the Martin County resolution for the upgrading of US 17 is not in the consent agenda.
Okay.
So we need to, I want it put on the agenda somewhere.
What's the pleasure of the
items for consent? I make a motion that it, that it be placed on the agenda.
Okay, we got a motion by Commissioner Brandt.
Second it.
Got a second by Commissioner Buzzio. Clarification, are you, that's moving to items for decision, is that?
Well, I mean, it can go under items for consent, you know, but if wherever the board wants it is fine with me.
I think we'll put it under consent.
Okay.
Make the motion.
All right, we put it under consent.
All right, with me.
All those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. Unanimous. Okay, now can we approve the all of the items for consent?
So moved.
Got a motion
second.
By Commissioner Buzzio and a second by Commissioner Brin. All those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. All those opposed, 6-1.
No.
Okay.
You got me positive.
Yes.
Okay.
There was one opposed, right?
We need this.
Okay. All right, we're down to items for presentation. The Foundation Forward presentation. Ron Lewis, First Lieutenant, United States Marine Corps, retired. Did I get it right?
No. Yes, sir. You got it right from the material, but I'm retired county manager. But I was a lieutenant in the Marine Corps. Glad we got that clarified.
Thank you.
As a retired county manager, I want to talk just for a second about what a fine county manager that you have. You know, those of us that are aging out have gotten to the point to where we can't function any longer in that stressful position. It's good to know that we have young people, that we have youngsters that are very qualified, highly trained, and very motivated to be great county managers. And you have one of the best. Anyone been to the Archives Building in Washington? Got one hand here?
Mm-hmm.
I got a head nodding over here. The Archives Building in I bet you saw the movie The National Treasure,
mm-hmm.
where the Declaration of Independence was stolen. That was the Archives Building. That's it there. Well, you enter through these big doors and suddenly open up into an area. And once you get in there, there's no hurry. You can take your time and look at everything. The Declaration of Independence is on the left, the four pages of the Constitution in the middle.
Light switch.
Lights. Thank you.
And the Bill of Rights is on the right. That's the view from above. They're in pretty bad shape, but they're in disrepair, and of course, time is taking its toll on them. The worst one is the Bill of Rights. You can hardly read it now. But the good thing about it is, once you get there, you can take all the time you want to peruse those. Again, the Declaration of Independence on the left, four pages of the Constitution in the middle, and the Bill of Rights is on the right. That's what it looks like on the outside of the Archives Building. The Founding Fathers were big on education, especially two of them, Thomas Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin. Old Ben was the senior statesman of the Founding Fathers. He did a lot of things, but the thing that's most important for us to remember historically is he was the sage. In other words, if those youngsters got stumped on a problem they didn't know how to solve, they would go to Old Ben and he would solve the problem. So he was the sage of the group. And of course, Thomas Jefferson was the third president of the United States. They were big on the three stages of education, the primary level, the secondary level, and the third level. It's not very different from what we have today. And they were big on civics and government, as you might realize. This is a historic courthouse in Morganton, North Carolina. Under this tree in 2012, Vance Patterson, the founder of our 501c3, said he'd like to bring that experience that he had in Washington with the at the Archives Building with the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, to the school kids of Burke County. So we set out to do that, to duplicate this experience in the counties across North Carolina. It became an educational project real quick. It was to design and build the replicas of the Charters of Freedom Monument as exhibited in Washington. We want the monument to be central to the community with high visibility, high foot traffic, and easy access for school children. There'll be three documents displayed just as they are in the Archives Building. Then we started to build it. And boy, have we learned a lot since that time. We started out really not knowing what we were doing. But as we continue to build them, we learn much better how to do it. We go down 3 feet subsurface and pour reinforced concrete. One of the gentlemen that works with us said that he could run an M1 tank into that and it wouldn't budge. But we intend for it to stay there. That's what the forum looks like once it's poured. We commissioned an artist to do a rendition of something that would represent the Charters of Freedom. The eagle is the Declaration of Independence, strong, defiant. The stars above represent the Articles of the Constitution. The stars below represent the Bill of Rights. That's what it looks like before the documents go into it. There's a time capsule in the back that we would like for you folks to put in there what you would like to have put in there. That's what the side documents look like before it's finished. Then come the documents. The documents are in brass. They weigh about 60 pounds a piece, and there's bulletproof glass that goes over the top of them. There's a dedication plaque and an information plaque that goes on the back of the monuments, recognizing people that helped contribute to them. The time capsule is to be opened on September the 17th, 2087, which is a celebration of the 300th anniversary of the United States Constitution. This is what we envisioned in the beginning, that school children would come with their teacher to learn about the Founding Fathers and what they did to create this great country, in addition to local history and other things. This is a dedication day. Veterans are there, and it's just a great day to celebrate the founding of our country. Now, when we started out to do this, there was a tree there, and come to find out the mayor of Morganton had planted that tree 40 years before that time. And in the meeting, when we said, where do you think we should put this? And we said where we wanted to put it, the room was totally silent. Because, that's the mayor's tree. But the mayor was the first man to say, you know, I think our tree's got to go. So that's what it looks like today. That's what it looks like from a different angle. The Declaration of Independence on the left, four pages of the Constitution, in the middle, and the Bill of Rights is on the right. We had so much fun doing the first one, we decided to do a second one. If you know a little bit about geography in North Carolina, Cherokee County is as far west as you can go and still be in North Carolina and not in Georgia and Tennessee. So we built one in Cherokee County. This is a site that they chose. This is what it looked like on dedication day. Foundation Forward became a 501c3 then, so that we could do these across the country and across, particularly in North Carolina. The third one was in Buncombe County. That's the site beside the government complex. That's what it looked like on dedication day. And that's the cutting of the ribbon. The third one, excuse me, the next one, that was actually the fourth one, goes and went to Morgan County in Jacksonville, Illinois. They picked a site right on the square, and that's what it looked like. Take a little closer look at this, because this was the first monument made of Indiana limestone. That is my preference. Come to find out, most of Washington, D.C. is built on Indiana limestone. I've learned, as I said earlier, we've learned how to do this better, and that's my preference, is the Indiana limestone. On dedication day, it was pouring down rain, and we had 250 people in the rain to see the dedication of the monument. There's one little girl, I couldn't refuse to take her picture. The next one was in Howard County, Kokomo, Indiana. They picked out a site on the courthouse square. It was also limestone. You can see that the landscaping does not have to be elaborate. It can be real simple and still be very effective. But this is what it's all about. Young families coming to see the founding documents of our country. There's a little girl again. There are 3,143 counties, parishes, and boroughs and special districts across the country. It's our goal over the next 9 years to build as many of those as we possibly can across the country. It's all about education, access, and the community. And this young lady doesn't have to go to Washington to see the founding documents. We want her to be able to see them in her hometown, in her own community. We'll go back to the archives building. You don't have to go to Washington to see them. What I'd like to do now, Madam Clerk, is start my brief video. One thing you have with young managers that you don't with old managers is competency on these things.
Unfortunately, a lot of people don't get to go to Washington, D.C. and see our founding documents.
So many people that I talk to don't know what the Charters of Freedom are. When we explain, they say, oh, yeah, I've heard about those. It's very important that the students not only know about the history, but why they should take pride in these documents.
Back in 2011, my wife and I were up in Washington, D.C. visiting with some congressmen and some of the organizations up there. We had some free time, so we decided to go over to the National Archives. You walk through these big bronze gates into this rotunda, and there are the founding documents over on the other side of the room. These are known as your Charters of Freedom. The first time I saw the Declaration of Independence, something our founding fathers had actually penned, and saw their signatures, Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, John Adams, Rutledge, and the others, I just got goosebumps. I remember the thought came to me, what if I could duplicate the experience I had up in Washington, the first time we saw the Charters of Freedom? What if I could bring that experience back to the citizens of Burr County? Then, on July 2nd, 2014, we dedicated the first Charters of Freedom monument outside of Washington, D.C.
From an educational standpoint, for our children to actually see it within their home counties, be able to touch it, feel it, and view it, it's a huge deal for veterans as well as for our children.
Imagine, if you will, third and fourth grade school teachers bringing their classes here for annual field trips to learn a little about the documents, a little about our government, our founding fathers, and also about state and local history while they're here.
I think with the educational system, teachers and educators are sometimes limited by the materials and just time. So to be able to provide teachers with the educational materials that they can use to kind of focus their visits to these sites, that's exciting to me.
When they talk of their charters of freedom in their hometown, remembering that their fourth grade school teacher took them down and taught them about the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, and the Declaration of Independence, we're in the beginning of what could be a massive re-education of our founding principles.
Our goal as a foundation is to set monuments in as many communities as possible over the next 9 years, to provide access to our founding documents in the communities so the children and the people of these communities don't have to go all the way to Washington, D.C. to experience these documents in a proper setting. But they will no longer talk about the Constitution and Bill of Rights in Washington. They'll be talking about their Constitution and their Bill of Rights, the ones they grew up with, right in their home community.
Thank you. I get my thumb wrong.
Commissioners, let me tell you the good news. We don't spend your money.
Plenty of delights.
We don't spend the county's money. The first thing I do is ask the county manager and Mr. Chairman, you and the board, where do you want me to open up the bank account? And I put $1,000 in a local bank to start our program. Then we like to have someone that's willing to be a local contact for us, that knows the people and can help me run the campaign here in your county. I promise you, as the treasurer of the corporation, every dollar that's collected in Beaufort County stays in Beaufort County. We don't commingle money whatsoever. I can swear to that. Vance Patterson is a manufacturer of a well-to-do businessman. He pays me for my time and my travel and that kind of stuff. But the second thing we want to do is for you to tell us an organization, perhaps the Chamber of Commerce, that we would join here. They normally have rates, special rates for private nonprofits. It costs us $100, $150 or something like that. And we begin to work with the business community. I would guess that within 60 to 90 days, we would have sufficient funds in hand to build a monument. Now, the foundation takes no cut out of that, 100%. In other words, we don't make a profit. We don't make money off the monuments. The only money that's used is what it takes to buy the materials to build a monument. We'll use local contractors. As a retired county manager, I've asked Vance Patterson at least a dozen times to let me spend the county's money. And every time he says, no, Ron, we're not going to do that. He has let me use some in-kind services. If you have a department that has a backhoe, will help us dig the footing, he lets us do that. If you have a local brick mason who wants to donate his time, then we'll accept that. But we will not take dollars out of your general fund budget or any of your budgets to pay for the monument. It's all public. It's all private money, not public money. I've gone over my time. I told them that I'd take about 10 to 15 minutes, and I think I've worn that out. So do you have any questions of me?
Does any of the commissioners have questions?
I have one question, if I may, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
What does a project like this usually cost?
We have built three types of monuments. The granite comes from Minnesota, from Cold Stone in Minnesota. The first one we built in Morganton cost $75,000. We've got that cost down now to about $65,000 by learning what we were doing and cutting corners and doing as much of it as we can ourselves. The Indiana limestone would be about $55,000. And now, we had a county in western North Carolina with a white brick courthouse. If you've ever been to Jackson County, which is Silva.
Yeah, Silva.
Silva has the beautiful white courthouse up on the side of the mountain. The chairman said to me one day, says, Ron, why can't we do a brick monument? I said, okay, let's do a brick monument. So we can build that brick monument for about $25,000. So those are the three options, Commissioner. It would be granite from Minnesota, Indiana limestone, or brick. And you can see the cost variance there. Any other questions?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis, I really do appreciate you coming tonight and talking to us about this project. It's something that I found talking to your folks about 2 years ago at one of our workshops.
Yes, sir.
And in fact, I'm the one that called you and asked you to come and give us this information. I've also talked to the city the city manager and some of the board members, and they've got a place that that we can put your monument.
Very good.
And I guess all we need now is to raise the money.
Yes, sir. I told Brian before the meeting, when we got 2 seconds to talk just before the meeting started, and I said, if there's a prettier county in North Carolina, I haven't seen it. And I think I've been to all of them. I think at one time or another, I've visited all 100 counties. But you have a beautiful county. And with the history that's here in your community, I can't think of a better place to put the Charters of Freedom than in your beautiful county.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions? Katie, can you put this back on the agenda for a decision at the next meeting?
Thank you, Commissioners.
Thank you very much.
I've got to decide if I'm going to drive 5 hours home or stop in Raleigh tonight. So have a
good evening. Spend the night in Beaufort County. Get up early.
It's a lot prettier.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, buddy.
Okay, next item is the Beaufort County Nursing Home Adult Care Community Advisory Committee Annual Report. Laura, thank you.
Thank you. Good evening. I'm Laura Jett. I am the Regional Long-Term Care Ombudsman. I did take that position in August of this year, so I'm fairly new to the position. But what you have before you tonight is our annual report, which spans October 2015 through September 2016. So what I wanted to do tonight is just highlight some of the items in the report and let you know how our committee is doing. I appreciate the new member that was appointed this evening to our committee. With the advisory committee report, the first question there is, were all the homes in the county served, all of our long-term care facilities? And the answer to that is no. The committee members are supposed to visit the nursing homes quarterly and the adult care homes quarterly, and then the family care homes in the county at least once annually. The issue we have had are we have the availability to have 10 members, but we currently only have 3 active members on that committee, and a visit to a home constitutes at least two members going. And so the committee as a group has not covered all those homes, but I have been going in their place to cover those. So that is probably the biggest challenge this year, and the thing that I want to focus on the most is building that advisory committee. Again, we had 4 when this was written, but we've had 1 step down since then due to health issues. So with the appointment tonight, we'll be back up to 4, but my hope would be to recruit at least 6 more in the coming year. The other issue is 2 of the homes are around Pantego and Bellhaven area, and we don't have committee members in those areas. So that's another area I'd like to focus my recruitment efforts on. Educational efforts that we go through with the committee, they come to a meeting with me every other month where I provide an educational topic, and then I also mail them an educational topic. So they get 12 units of education each year. And I focus those on a lot of what I see in the facilities and also what's going on in the community. So this year, with an election year, we talked a little bit about voter rights and what you can and can't do in a facility setting. We also talked about emergency preparedness as we had Hurricane Matthew coming through and what the facility's responsibilities are during that time. Item three, community involvement by the committee. The three members we have are very active. They are doing their visits locally, and then separately they just go and visit in the facilities with people they know and get to know the facilities outside of their duties. They also are involved in the Alzheimer's Walk each year, in senior center activities, and then their local church group. So they are very involved in the community. As far as problems encountered by the committee, again, it really comes down to manpower right now, having enough on the committee to adequately cover the facilities. And then family care homes, that particular type of home, a lot of their residents are gone during the day, and so it's a matter of structuring our visits so that we actually meet the residents, because that's really our goal, is we're their advocate, and we can't advocate if we can't meet them and hear what their needs are and their concerns. Our committee does not resolve grievances. They generally, if they have grievances in the facility, at this point they feel more comfortable referring them to me so that I can go and help resolve those grievances. Let's see. And then just an idea of how many facilities we do have. We have the two nursing home facilities, five adult care homes, and currently one family care home. We did have three family care homes, but two have closed, so we're down to one. So that is all from the report, but I'd like to answer any questions you may have of me.
Any of the commissioners got questions for Laura? If not, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, we move into items for discussion. The first one is conflict of interest for employees, elected and appointed officials. Commissioner Richardson.
Okay, I have an issue that has to do with conflict of interest of county employees in general. I just changed my page because I thought we were going to another subject.
260.
Yeah, okay. The situation involves the corporation of Beaufort 360, which is a group that was formed and paid for by, I guess, the federal government of several counties, the purpose of which was to explore new ways to get various agencies to work together. The funding ended for that about 8 months ago. The group has gone out and incorporated itself as an advocacy group, the purpose of which is to make government work smoother and to facilitate various interdepartmental items. They have leaders that make the decisions for them. They made a presentation, in case some of this sounds familiar, at the last commissioner's meeting. On that committee is the county manager, the health director, someone from the community college, social services director, the school superintendent, and someone who does child advocacy. I don't know why I'm having trouble with that word, in Beaufort and Hyde counties. Their goal is to dispense grant funds that they intend to secure. The problem that I have as a commissioner, and I put yourself in the position for those of you who are in business, that you're in business, and all of a sudden you look out there and you see about 8 or 10 of your employees that have gone out and formed an advocacy group. Gosh, I'm going to have to practice that word. Advocacy group. Well, what's going on here? How can you run your business? How can you expect these people to be loyal to you for what you're supposed to be doing if they've gone out and formed an association of their own? I raised the issue with the county manager, and he says, in essence, there is not a conflict of interest in this. For me, supposedly looking after the people of Beaufort County, from a fiduciary standpoint, there is a conflict of interest. The goals of this group sound almost identical to the goals that the commissioners have. That is, you guys go out there and you work together and make this thing work smoothly, and when your departments can interact and support each other, you need to be doing that. We don't need you at conflict with each other. So from my standpoint, looking after the voters of Beaufort County, when my employees all go out and form another group somewhere and say that they're going to be doing the same things that I'm paying them for, there is definitely a conflict. There is a conflict of interest policy within the Beaufort County personnel policy. And that there, the items that I think apply to that, it's two short paragraphs, I'm going to read them. An employee is prohibited from having a direct or indirect formal interest that conflicts substantially by his or her government duties and responsibilities, or from joining in directly or indirectly a formal transaction as a result of or primarily relying upon information obtained through his or her government employment. Employees should refrain from transmitting any knowledge of county considerations or decision or any other information which might be prejudicial, gosh, I got that right, to the interest of the county, to any person other than in connection with the discharge of his official duties. Those official duties demand that that employee be loyal to his employer, which is this board. So when it comes to doing budgets and when it comes to asking for money, and then these employees, it's virtually impossible for them to be loyal to two masters. Can't be done. It is bad policy for this board to allow our employees to go out and form these associations, because we're paying for them to do identically the same thing for us that they avow that they've gone out and joined this other group to do. And within that other group is not just entirely government employees. There are a lot of other interest groups that are a part of this. And the best way to describe Beaufort 360 is that it's a grant mill. They intend to get grant money and dispense it in various ways within the county. So in my view, these are conflicts of interest. The Board of County Commissioners should take up the issue. We should ask these employees to step down from these positions.
Are you finished?
Yes.
Okay. Any comments from any commissioner?
I have a number of comments.
Go ahead,
Mr. Chairman.
Commissioner Buzziak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. There was an interesting article in the paper recently about Beaufort County 360 and the function it performs. And one of the major projects they're working on now is homeless shelter for women and children, which we don't have. So I don't look at that as a conflict. I look at that, and I'd like to congratulate any county employee that gets involved on their own time, or even on county time, with some of the organizations we have. It was mentioned earlier, we're a Tier 1 county. We have a lot of needs out there. The county itself can't fulfill all those needs. But I have another issue that I want to raise. You know, it works both ways. We want our employees loyal to us, and we need to be loyal to our employees. There was a recent article last week in one of our tabloids in this county that went ahead and attacked three of our employees, three loyal employees that were doing their job, and they were charged with corruption. And I assume everybody knows what the word corruption stands for. And I went ahead and make sure I was correct on it, printed out a number of things that talks about corruption. Doing things that are dishonest or illegal in order to make money or gain or keep power, our employees aren't doing that. There happen to be very outstanding employees. Having or showing a willingness to act dishonestly in return for money or personal gain, these employees weren't doing that. Dishonest? No. Unscrupulous? No. Dishonorable? No. Criminal? No. Those three employees fulfill none of the definitions of corrupt. But we had one of our commissioners here write an article and name those three employees. Outstanding employees to this county. If we should be talking about conflicts, I know where the conflict is. And that commissioner, using their position to attack our employees, it's sad, it's unprofessional, it's unwarranted, it's libelous, it's degrading. Should be ashamed of himself. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Any other comments? If you go back to the meeting that we had last month, you know, I listened to the presentation of the 360, and it was for discussion purposes, better inform us about what was going on. Nowhere in that process did they ask the county for any money. To me, the internal control that we have is when we go through the budget process, I think that's where the commissioners have the final say if we think there's a real conflict. Personally, looking at the conflict and based on my training in the School of Government, unless there's money going directly into the employee's checking account, I don't think there's a conflict. I think that we understand at that point when you cross that line. So I don't have any problems as a commissioner with employees working together in a group to try to make our community a better place. To me, it's an exchange of ideas. I mean, I'm not sure where they're going, but I think everybody that's in that group is pretty smart, and we're going to have to trust them and give them the confidence to do what they need to do. Okay. Item number two, high requests for nonprofits and charities are placed on the agenda and the budget. Commissioner Richardson.
I would ask the county manager to explain to us the rules for how we go about accepting requests for grants for what I characterize as charity within the budget process.
Within the budget process, the way it's set up and the way we did it last year and the way I've always done it is that if you have an item that is currently in the budget, if you have an organization, an outside organization, say for example, anybody pick one that you fund. You fund Eagles Wings, I believe. So Eagles Wings was in the budget for the last umpteen years. When we came in last year, we said it was getting, and I'll just throw a number, I don't know, $1,000, $2,000. So we put that in the continuation budget and show that that's what the board has consistently put in. If there's additional money requested, then we put that in as a service expansion. If a new organization comes in that was not previously funded in a prior year, they go into a service expansion role. All the service expansions go to the board individually for them to look at, discuss, and decide whether you want to put money in there or not. You also have the option as you go through the budget workshops to delete or take out existing funds that you have. That's the way your budget process works.
What kind of documents do they submit? Just a letter requesting the money?
Yes, sir. We receive from them a budget document that they show us their budget, where they receive their funding from, how much they're expecting from us, because obviously that is something that you would want to know. If someone said, I want $50,000 from Beaufort County, and you said, well, how much money are you putting into it, or where are you getting your other money? They say, none, and I'm spending it all on my salary. Then you'd say, well, obviously we don't want to fund that. So we ask for that information. We also ask for their financials, and all that information is provided.
Well, what raises this issue is, for me, we're going into the budget, and that's why it's brought up at this particular time. We're going to the budget process. There's no doubt over the years that commissioners have given charity to their favorite charities, and this is a problem because we give quite a bit of money doing this. And I'm hoping that in this budget this year that we're going to be looking at reducing the amount of charity that we give away simply because it's tax money. Any member of the public that's paying taxes can give to charity as much as they want to give. It's not up to me as a county commissioner to use the police power of the state to take your money and then to give it to my favorite charity. That's not the way this should work. And this is an issue with me. It's been an issue as long as I've been a commissioner. Government should not be in the charity business, but we are in the charity business to something at least $200,000 a year, maybe more than that. That's a lot of money for hardworking people in Beaufort County for us to take their money by force and then decide who our good buddies are that we're going to give that money to. Not that these are not worthy causes that we're talking about. They are. But we don't need to twist arms, forcibly take people's money and give it to charities. So I will be working on that real hard during this particular budget that's coming up.
Brian?
Just a point of clarification, the board cannot expend money that is not for a public purpose. So anything that the board, even if you're funding an outside agency, there's you've got to have that public purpose piece. So we're not funding folks who are not, that you are not allowed by general statutes and the Local Budget Fiscal Control Act to fund.
As far as the process is concerned, I think for the public to understand, since this is televised, as we go into the budget process, if you want to be considered in the budget, then you need to be calling the county manager's office or the chief financial officer and asking Anita or Brian for an application form.
Mr. Chairman, if I
yes,
may.
Sir.
Do a little advertising for the charity group. The local government officials at the local government commission say that the public purpose definition is broken. That the way the public purpose definition is used, it covers virtually everything, everywhere. There are no exceptions.
Any other comments? All right, we're down to the third item. Require building inspection supervisor to obtain the minimum level of building code license. Mr. Richardson.
Well, you know, Commissioner Buzzio has referred to me accusing public officials of doing things that are dishonest. I still have the opinion that the Belhaven Hospital was torn down because of the county's basic dishonesty. We had no business to be down there. We had already issued whatever permits they needed to tear it down, but a temporary restraining order was issued. So guess what? The county goes down, writes a letter. I sat in the courtroom, heard the judge refer to the letter over and over while he refused to have rebuttal on the letter as his reason for lifting the TRO so that the hospital could be torn down. He knew that within a matter of hours when he lifted that TRO, it was going to be torn down because it was brought up in court. It's dishonest any way that you look at it. Beaufort County is responsible for the loss of the hospital, 60% of which was less than 20 years old in Belhaven. So how could it possibly need demolition? We have one building inspector who did this. We have two building inspectors, and he did this. He's a nice person. I like him. I was really surprised when I saw that he had did what he did because he made misleading and false statements in the letter that he wrote, like the roof structure is failing. It was a steel roof structure, folks. The floors are falling in. Not all the floors were falling in. The kitchen had some bad floor problems. They put the backhoe on the hospital to tear it, on the floor of the hospital to tear it down. So how could all of the floors be failing? This was the only person who has anything to lose in this process was that building inspector. And I believe, and in the past, let me go back a little bit in history. The last time that we had a county planner, the building inspectors worked for the planner at that time, the county planner was required, as the supervisor of those building inspectors, to get the minimum level of building inspection license that's required by the state of North Carolina. That's called, I believe, the administrative part of it. And it basically concerns the law and how the law works, having to do with building inspections. It's not going out and saying you did that wrong or you built this wrong or you didn't do this or you didn't do that. If more than one person had had something to lose in that process, the public would have had a better buffer against what really happened in the tearing down of the hospital. I still, to this day, do not believe that the county manager, the county planner, and the building inspector would have done what they did without some support from this board. Chairman Langley made an apology to the manager for me saying bad things about him at the last meeting. Well, guess what, folks? I wasn't talking about just the manager. I was talking about the process, and I was also talking about this board not doing their duty to keep that hospital from being torn down. There's corruption in this process, and you'll see it when it all plays out. So what I'm requesting that this board do is require the county planner, if he's going to supervise building inspectors, to obtain the minimum level of certification that's necessary for, from the Department of Insurance as a part of his duties. Now, it was done this way when we had a planner, 10 years or so ago. So I think we should go back to that. It should have been in his job description when he was hired this time.
Brian, do you know of any violations as it relates to state statute on the licensing side and the requirements of the building inspectors? I mean, do we have anybody that's lacking?
No, sir. All our building inspectors, our chief building inspector is certified in all three levels. There were two building inspectors that actually walked through that building. No, I mean, our folks are compliant. Does our planning director hold building certifications? No, he doesn't.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
Does our planning director meet the job description that he was hired on?
He does.
That's all that matters.
And he meets, that includes the education, knowledge, and abilities, duties, and responsibilities?
He does.
So he's fulfilling his obligation for what we hired him for?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Manager.
Well, I disagree. He's not fulfilling his obligation for what we hired him for because we didn't hire him to tear a hospital down. We didn't hire the county manager to tear a hospital down either. This is being played out. Charges have been brought against the building inspector. His license is on the line.
Mr. Chairman, may I speak to that?
Yes.
There are not charges that have been brought against the building inspector. There's been a complaint filed against the building inspector by one of the sitting commissioners from the town of Belhaven. In his logic in making that, he wrote one of his complaints was that the building inspector, there are certain things that you can file a complaint against the building inspector for. One of those that he checked was that the building inspector signed a document that he did not supervise or did not do himself. Well, that is incorrect. Our building inspector walked that building upon request of the owner, which is what we would do as we spoke at the last meeting on any property that we were asked to come and inspect due for safety reasons. We would do that. It's our responsibility under the North Carolina General Statutes to do that. A letter was issued to the building owner to say these are the items that need to be corrected if you intend to open this place back up.
Oh, my. Gee, you just stepped into it, but go ahead. Go ahead.
Commissioner Richards, have you finished, Brian?
There are several items. So there were not charges that were brought. The second piece was that he said he willfully and intentionally and neglectfully misused his or did something inappropriate. He was doing his job, which is what he's required to do. When we get a complaint from an adjacent property owner, if we get a complaint from a tenant who lives in a property, then we have an obligation to go and review that and issue a notice to say these are the things you need to correct before you can get back in that building. And I think that will play out. We are going through that process right now. And in fact, the documentation that the person who complained sent to the state was a copy of Commissioner Richardson's column out of his newspaper.
Jeez.
So we have spent the last couple of weeks, myself, the county attorney, and several of our folks, a good 10 hours worth replying to that. So we have done what we are supposed to do, and our employees have done their job as we talked about earlier. I know Commissioner Richardson doesn't believe that. The reason, as I read the transcript, the reason that judge lifted the TRO was because there was a complaint that the fiduciary responsibility of the managers had been breached. He ruled that their fiduciary responsibility had not been breached, and the reason the hospital was torn down was because an overwhelming majority of the members of that board voted to do that. It had nothing to do with Beaufort County doing its job and saying there are issues with this building, which I think everybody understood there were issues with that building. And it is difficult as an administrator in this organization to hire and recruit good talent and to have people that we want to work for us when they are belittled and talked about inappropriately.
That's right.
And it's difficult. Now, we struggle with that every day. What I tell our folks in staff meeting is try to stay out of the fray. Please try to stay out of the fray. I can't do anything for you if you get into the political fray. That's what I get paid for, and that's what I get paid to get beat up for. But I will tell you this. I've worked in local government for 20 years. I worked in the private sector for 5 years. Never in my career have I ever been called corrupt or had my integrity challenged. And I will tell you that I will not do that because I understand my job and I understand what is responsible, what I'm responsible to do. So I would say that and I'll be quiet. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Commissioner Langley asked if he could speak.
Mr. Manager, last month I told you how I felt about this whole situation, and I just want to ask you a few questions. Did Beaufort County order the demolition of the hospital?
No, sir.
Was Beaufort County the owner of the hospital?
No, sir.
What role did Beaufort County have in anything at the hospital?
None.
So it is a moot. I don't know why we're constantly having to deal with this every month. We need to just simply move on from this. The building has been demolished. There's no culpability with the county, and so we simply need to move forward.
Commissioner Brent.
As I said last week, last month's meeting, I took a tour of the hospital by the request of the LLC, just so I could see what kind of situation it was in. Floors were wet, holes in the floors. You could see the ground underneath through the floor, water standing underneath it. There was leaks in the roof, and the kitchen floor completely collapsed. And I'm gonna be perfectly honest with you. I'm getting a little fed up with Commissioner Richardson beating up on staff. If he's got anything to say to staff, he needs to say it in private instead of out in public. I don't like it. None of the commissioners like it.
I can't make a motion to say.
And I know you don't care. But that man sitting right over there is the best manager this county's ever had. And you try to belittle him every meeting you try to do that.
He needs to straighten up.
Oh, he don't need to straighten up. He's doing his daggone job, Hood.
Well,
and I'll tell you, I'm sick and fed up with it.
Mr. Chairman, I have one final statement.
Anybody else have anything to say? Okay, you got 1 minute.
Well, the manager said that they were down, that any time a building is to be reopened or repaired, that the building inspector has to go do an inspection.
I didn't say that.
2 weeks before that, the county had already issued the demolition permit, the paperwork that they needed to tear the hospital down. What had happened was a temporary restraining order against that was in court. So what does the county do? A big political favor that could be used in court by a judge who would not allow the letter from the building inspector to be challenged because I was sitting in court when it happened. What has gone on here is not right. It is a dishonest process. There was no reason for the county to go back to that property if they'd already issued the paperwork for the hospital to be torn down, other than to do a big favor for some of their buddies in a court case. It is corrupt.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Those comments weren't. You should be censored. And you're lucky I can't make a motion because we're having a discussion here. But these continual attacks have to stop. This board and our county employees had nothing to do with the tearing down. You heard the county manager.
They did.
It was done because
you're in outer space.
You filed this TRO based upon mismanagement and a judge threw it out.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I'm going to have the final comment. And this is a question for our county manager. Brian, did any time during this process did I call you and tell you to send the building inspector down there?
No, sir.
Let's just clear the air. That's one of the acquisitions that's out there. We're going to move on into items for decision. And Martin?
Thank you.
You're going to introduce the backup group?
Yes. Okay. Mr. Dick Barber, who is the president of the Committee of 100, and he'll be available to answer questions through the presentation if necessary. And we also have a number of people from the Committee 100 in the audience, and if a question relates to their speciality, I hope they'd stand up and answer that question. So I come before you tonight on behalf of the Beaufort County Economic Development Advisory Board to request that Beaufort County partner with the Committee 100 to construct on site number 2 in the Washington Beaufort County Industrial Park an industrial-ready building. If people don't know, site number 2 is the blue one here, just across from Egret Boats. There are 4 businesses currently in the industrial park. One to the north here is Oak Ridge Metals. Below that is, and they employ about 60 people. Below that is AAF Flanders. They employ about 130 people. On the red piece to the on the curve there is Rough Brothers, and they employ about 30 people. And then next to us at the Skills Center is Egret Boats that employs about 12 people. Looking at the site in more detail, so this is the blue site that you were looking at. We're looking basically at about 5.507 acres of land. As you can see, it'll face onto Page Road with parking in the front and truck docks on the side. The building is expandable to the rear or to the west by another 22,500 feet, which is what the building is. And then it could flip again and be made into a 90,000 square foot building. That size from about 20,000 to 90,000 is a majority of the prospects that I see. So the proposal itself, moving on, is that the Beaufort County purchases the City of Washington's 45% interest in site number 2 at $7,000 per acre, which would equal $17,347.05. This is permissible under North Carolina General Statute 160A-274. Beaufort County would then contribute the total site, which would be a value of about $38,549, to the Committee of 100 for a share of the building sale proceeds or lease revenues. Beaufort County would also reimburse the Committee of 100 for interest, legal, marketing, and maintenance costs up to $77,653, but not to be more than $35,000 per year. As the building development costs will be about $1 million, the $116,202 contribution by the county would represent about 11.62% of that price. Then the county would receive 11.62% of the net profits from the proceeds of the building or any rental income that the building creates from the Committee 100. Committee 100 will contribute 20% of development costs or $200,000. And the Committee of 100 will finance the remaining costs and guarantee any loan that they take out. The exposure for Beaufort County will not go beyond the $116,202, and will have final approval in determining the fair market price of any sale of the property. As I said, the building is 22,500 square feet. And unlike many shell buildings, the Committee 100 will put the floor in the building and have it in shape that the space could be leased for warehouse. So there could be some immediate revenue given the shortage of space in the community. So why we're looking at creating some more space in Beaufort County? Basically, there's a lack of availability of buildings in Beaufort County, both for entrepreneurs and industrial prospects looking to invest in the county and create jobs. Of the 90 proposals that I've put out since I started in September 2014, 48% of those, just a little less than half of them, have been for this sized building, from the 20 to 90,000 square feet. Currently, I have 7 leads in the pipeline that are planning to expand or are looking for similar facilities in, to those of the proposed building. Also, I've been sending out a lot of plans like this to companies that basically I say, you know, come here and look what we might be able to build for you. Without it being built, there is actually, you know, this is what we have. There's been no testing, say, of the land. There's permits from the city and others that would need to be received. So in terms of construction costs, companies see, hey, that's probably going to take me about 6 months. And they perceive that as risk. Not only risk in time, but also risk, what if they find something in the ground? By creating the shell building, all that permitting, all that investigation will be done beforehand, and typically saving about 6 months in terms of constructing a building. The shell building will be marketed by myself, obviously, but also by the Committee of 100 to all the businesses that they're related to in various ways and manners. The Northeast Alliance Partnership, which we give $40,000 a year to market Beaufort County. Electricities, which provides through the City of Washington the electricity to this site. The Economic Development Partnership of North Carolina, who is currently recreating their building and site database, and this would obviously be in that database, and also for other allies such, well, as yourselves, and also, say, the Beaufort Washington Chamber of Commerce. The marketing efforts would then also be assisted by other local, regional, state, and federal programs, incentive programs that are designed to help Tier 1 counties. We would market the building to those industries from the U.S. and around the globe that are similar in manufacturing labor skills as those that are currently in Beaufort County. We can definitely show that we have labor skills in certain areas, and we can attract businesses for that. In terms of manufacturing, a recent study has shown that manufacturing jobs pay 66% higher than the average county wage of North Carolina. So we want to, you know, locate this building to help increase the wealth of our workforce. Also, the building will be marketed as part of the Greenville, Washington Combined Statistical Area, using all the statistics and infrastructure services that are in that area. Basically, that is Pitt and Beaufort counties. There's 230,000 people in that area, major university, major medical center. This building would be 30 minutes from all of that. Also, we would obviously sell Beaufort County in terms of access to waterfront living, and as I said earlier, the workforce. There are 3 interstates that are going to be made, hopefully in the next 20 years. US 264 become I-587, US 64, I-495, and US 70, I-42, all within 30 to 45 minutes of this building. So there will be great transportation access. In terms of current buildings available, there are about 5 competitive buildings in eastern North Carolina. These are competition, I'd agree, but they also form the basis of the inventory of buildings in eastern North Carolina. Companies come, they may not come just for one building, but they'll come and take a look at 4 or 5. Also, given the election and the prospects for growth, I think this is a great opportunity to step forward and take advantage of that growth. Dr. Walden from NC State has said there's going to be about 2.3% growth in payroll in North Carolina for 2017. Interestingly, non-durable goods are going down, but durable goods, which is what we produce containment, marine goods, transportation, metal fabrication, mining equipment, and plastic goods. All these goods, the durable goods, are actually the ones that are increasing in terms of employment in the USA. Also, there are many testimonials from everybody in the economic development community. I put a few in your presentation. John Chafee of the Northeast Alliance, sorry, North Carolina, East Alliance, said that 75% of Northeast Alliance's prospects specify a desire to find an existing building. Jason Semple, who is the Martin County economic developer, stated minimizing startup time and associated costs is critical to companies looking for new locations. Sheila Pierce Knight, who is the Onslow County developer, stated that you need product to sell. 65% of her leads request an existing building. So, for all that information and reasoning, I'd love the County Board of Commissioners to pass a motion in support of the Beaufort County Economic Development Advisory Board's recommendation to accept the proposal for Beaufort County to partner with Beaufort County Committee of 100 to construct on site number 2 a 22,000 square foot shell building, and to allow the chairman to sign all necessary documents associated with this proposal.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I'd like to ask some questions before you get to a motion.
Go right ahead.
Number one, you know, the county would share in this. How would that work? We would have the deed to the property. Who are we going to deed the lot to?
The lot would be sold to the Committee 100. We would have an agreement with them.
Okay. They're going to give us back a promissory note?
A promissory note, yes.
As opposed to a deed of trust?
Yes.
But I'd like to ask the county attorney if that works.
Yeah. It's a revenue sharing.
Excuse me, Dick.
I'm sorry.
Would you step right up there? Randy's trying to record.
It's a great question. And we've been talking with Brian off and on over the last 2 or 3 months to make sure that we do this both properly and fairly. And so it's a revenue sharing position that the county would have in this investment. And Brian, you correct me, the School of Government's looked at this and given its approval.
We looked at a couple of different pieces. Obviously, under 158.7.1, the county can participate in economic development projects. You've done that before. The concern, as we understood it, was the exposure. You built a building, you were involved in a building that was built, the deal fell through, we went through the recession, you had a piece of property that stayed there for a while and finally got sold. There was some concern that the amount that was invested, you weren't able to return because you had to sell it at a lower price. That building currently is fully occupied with 150 employees right now who are doing business out there. So the Committee 100 came in and said, we've got a void in this community, in this county, where we don't have any product to sell. Your economic development director has been saying that since he's been here. The Committee 100 said, we got to figure out a way to do that. What we were very clear with the Committee 100 is we don't think we can get the Board of Commissioners to do that because they've been burned and they're concerned about that exposure. The Committee 100 said, tell you what, you got to partner with us because we can't do it on our own. But if you partner with us, we'll take the liability. You'll have a set exposure, which is what you have here. 116,202 is your maximum exposure. It's over a 3-year period, no more than, 35 a year. So if the building sells before that, you're out. There is a partnership that would go into this. There'd be a nonprofit that would be formed. And there would be a share of that you would be a partner in this nonprofit. And you would be insulated from the Committee 100 is going to take all the risk on the loan, $700,000 loan. And your only exposure is going to be on what you've put in it, as you put in it, and then if it is sold or if it is rented or leased for storage, then you receive a proportionate share of those revenues back.
Okay, you're headed in the direction that I was going, and that is, how do we keep the counties, if you have a lot and we deed you the lot, okay, and we can't do it with a deed of trust because then we're going to have to sign off on all your loans. Everything else, we become a party to this. That's why I was saying give a promissory note unsecured for the lot. Then you put that into the partnership, and the county's fingerprints nor the county's liability is on the deed of trust. I would ask the attorney, does that work?
Sounds like it would work, yes. I don't know that that's exactly what they've come up with.
If it's not what they've
got approval.
If it's not what they've come up with, then somebody needs to tell us now.
David, at this point in time, we do not have an agreement that's been drawn up.
No, that's correct.
So I'm assuming that what the concerns that Commissioner Richardson has, we can incorporate it in that agreement.
May I approach?
Yes.
For the record, I'm Jim Chestnut, Chairman of the Committee of 100, and we have heard and observed for so long that our economic development manager is going to market with nothing to sell. We don't have space in this county. A couple of pieces that are minimal at best and not very attractive. So for a long time, we've scratched our head and tried to figure out how the Committee of 100, whose sole two functions in this county are to create jobs and create tax base. That's our sole two functions. We have a nice lunch and everyone pays for it. I understand. Was it the Blue Goose Hood?
The Blue Goose.
I understand the feelings within the commission and maybe in the community about the Blue Goose, and the county took some losses on it. I submit to you today in that building, or how many people working? 130 people. If you were to ask those 130 people and look at the economic multiplier over a number of years, that we would probably find that even the Blue Goose might have made sense, even though we lost a lot of money on it. And it should be done differently. And I agree with Commissioner Hood that we should do it differently. So we knew we had to get creative. And somebody said tonight that we have the best county manager in this state, and I believe that. Because it's not easy to try to accomplish what we're trying to do, that the Committee of 100 has as its ultimate goal to create tax base and jobs. It's not easy to do that. So we said, let's go out and throw it against the wall and see what will work. And what we're asking the county to do, first of all, we went to the city and the county and asked for cooperation to do a public-private partnership. How far do you think that got us? So, the proposition is that the county acquire the 45% piece of that lot that's owned by the city, and the county will become the owner of it. Then that the county, as their equity contribution to a partnership, David, that has to be formed, that the Committee of 100 will own 89% and it'll be 11%. And let's don't work on the math now. The lawyers will work on the math. But it's about 89-11. That we'll have a partnership. Now, that partnership, with a contribution of $200,000 of equity and the land as equity from the county, is going to go to the local banks, who are very, very cooperative, and we're going to leverage up whatever it takes to put that building up, which is about another $800,000. Bob, is that in the ballpark? About another $800,000, and we'll have this building, and we'll put it on the market. And we are fairly confident that we can borrow the $800,000 and give that building as collateral in the partnership owned by the county and the city and the Committee 100. Then we're going to offer it for sale, and before we sell it, the partners are going to agree to what the selling price is, because we're going to have a partnership agreement as we get into it, and we're going to agree with that before we sell the building. I can tell you that the Committee of 100 has the confidence in Martin that he's going to find someone to put in this building, either in a lease, and if it's done by a lease, the lease to a company that can support it, then we'll take that lease and we'll get a long-term commitment on that bank, on that building, and we'll own a piece of property in a partnership, of which The county will get 11% of the income. The committee 100 will get 89% of the income. If we sell it at break even, we'll all be pretty happy. We'll take our capital and go home, and we'll create jobs and cash and tax base. If we don't sell it in 3 years, then the committee of 100 then will assume its responsibility to pay the interest to take that building, carry it forward until such time as we can find a buyer or someone to lease it. So we're not without risk. Fortunately, our committee at 100 is one of the strongest in the state of North Carolina. And what it has done for this community in the last year, and the number of years since it's been founded, has been unbelievable, and most people don't even know it. We're ready to do that and be your partnerhood.
Let me put on my commissioner hat.
Okay.
All I'm trying to do, my goal is to see to it that the county's name is not on a deed of trust.
I totally agree with you. It will not be on a deed of trust.
All right. If we can do that, we're making progress.
But you've got to give us up to $116,000, guys.
Whatever the amount's in writing, right. We are able.
And that's it.
Right. Now, let me say a couple of things here. I think we have made wonderful progress in economic development. Number one, the county's liability in this. I'm going to vote against this as a matter of
principle. Well, I knew that.
Because the county shouldn't be out getting into the business using the taxpayers' money. But the plus things about this is you have now limited the county's liability in this process, whereas before it was an unlimited liability. If our name's not on the deed of trust, we know how much money, we've got a partnership agreement, at least we're doing business like business people. Now, let me say one more thing. I'm, as I said, Moses at the last meeting. I feel like Moses because I've been here forever. When the county started the economic development process, part of the plan was that there would be a committee of 100 and that ultimately the committee of 100 would sit on its own bottom, do its own financing, and would not need the county. That is one of the reasons why the commissioners have always facilitated the grants that the committee could get with the money from the surpluses from those grants and those business deals that you have done so successfully roll over to the committee of 100. So, to put it crudely, we could be rid of you. But
no, you couldn't be rid of us.
That's success.
And I'll put that crudely. You couldn't do without the Committee of 100. We created more jobs than the counties has. Other than government, we've created more jobs than the county has.
You're going in the wrong direction. You're being defensive.
No, I'm not being defensive. I'm being realistic. And I was not here 19 years when it was formed.
Obviously.
He's saying that he wants you to take it all over. He wants you to employ me.
The goal is for the committee of 100 to sit on its own bottom without needing the county at all. Now, within these million-dollar processes, you are now within 11% of that. The process has been successful, and I congratulate the committee on being successful and on managing what you've done so well. But you would not have been that successful without somebody like me sitting here beating you with a stick all the way to keep you in line.
No, we would not have been successful without the Golden Leaf Foundation.
So you have done a great job, and I want you to continue to do a great job, and I want you to get away from needing government money to do this. And that's wonderful when you do.
Okay, Commissioner Brand.
I got one question.
All right.
What's the height to the ceilings in that building?
22 feet. 26 feet.
26. Is there any reason why we're not going to do 30-foot ceilings?
You don't need it.
You sure?
Yeah, 30 feet is very high, particularly.
30 feet is not desirable because the number of people that would need 30 feet don't want to have to heat and cool it if they don't need it.
And I got that building.
I wanted to know what your reason
was. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it's basically heating and cooling.
Okay.
Commissioner Booth.
Well, after hearing the presentation and before I came down this afternoon, I think it's Onslow County is having a groundbreaking this afternoon, and we are having a jawjacking.
How are they paying for it?
But the thing that I want to do is, if I'm in order, I would make a motion that the commissioner, the manager, and the committee of 100 get together and work out the details, and we support this private partnership.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, got it. Motion by Commissioner Booth and a second by Commissioner Buzzio.
Damn, but I thought you were going to second that.
No.
But before we take the vote,
What I'm saying is give him the go-ahead to go ahead and start the process.
Okay. One of the things I would encourage you to do is that it appears to me that we have found a partnership that looks like will work with the commissioners and with the Committee 100, and I would like you to think long-term that this agreement that you draw up is a template for the next one, assuming that you move somebody in there pretty shortly and hopefully they buy it, is that then we're going to need the next building to be.
You instruct your lawyer and we'll instruct ours. I agree.
Okay. you've heard the motion. You've heard the motion and the second. Brian?
Just one comment. When you expend economic development funds, you need to have a public hearing on that. We talked about this before the meeting. Conceptually, if you agree with this and you want to move forward, you could tonight go ahead and direct us to acquire the property from the city. You can do that under the statute that Martin referenced without you telling us to do that and us bringing you a budget amendment that allow us to do that. You could go ahead and do that. In order to enter into the agreement and set aside funds with this, which you want to see the agreement anyway,
right.
What we'll need to do is put that together and then advertise for a public hearing. You'll need to receive comments of the public hearing, have the documents in front of you, and then you can vote to finalize that.
We're going to set up a budget ordinance.
We would have to do a budget ordinance, right. Just like we normally do anytime you expend funds.
Good.
But that would be the process that you would go through.
Would you like to change your motion?
I would.
I don't think his motion needs to be changed, Mr. Chairman. I think he said
what I said.
But you're asking us for a second motion to go ahead and acquire.
If you want to do that, I think you can. You can go ahead and vote to acquire the property from the city right now if you want to, because that's something that can be done between governments. And the statute allows that. You don't have to have a public hearing to do that. But to engage in the economic development piece where you're entering into a partnership and where you are expending funds, you're required to have a public hearing and receive public comment on that. Then you can vote to take that action.
Okay. I need to ask mine a question.
Go right ahead.
Has anyone talked to the city about acquiring this land?
Yes.
Everything's good with the city?
They know about it.
We have talked to the city. The city as
I just want to go in there blind.
As Mr. Chestnut.
Well, they'd probably like you to buy the entire 45%.
As Mr. Chestnut said previously, there were some initial conversations with the city in order that the city and the county and the Committee 100 partner, take all three of us together to do that. The city didn't want to do that, so the option for us to move forward was for the county to acquire their interest in that piece, which is what is being listed here, and then it would be the county and the Committee 100 in the partnership.
Okay, we got a motion on the floor and a second. All those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. All those opposed, vote 6-1. Okay, at this point in time, we'll entertain.
Mr. Chairman, may I have the privilege of one more comment?
Yes.
There are a lot of jobs in this county that would have never, ever have been created and retained without the city, the county, and the Committee of 100. And for that, I thank the commission and prior commissions for doing that, because economic development and job creation is all about partnerships and cooperation. All about it. Thanks.
Okay. I will entertain a motion if someone wants to make a motion to go ahead and acquire the 45% interest.
Second.
Got a motion by Commissioner Booth and a second by Commissioner Brin. All those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. Can't see.
7-0.
The vote was 7-0. Ladies and gentlemen, we're gonna take a break and we'll be back in 10 minutes if you'd like to see us in 10 minutes.
So, ma'am, yeah, I can get it.
heard you, Mr. Chairman.
During our break, Anita went and did the budget amendment that we just on the approval of buying the 45%. So I'd like to entertain a motion to go ahead and approve the budget amendment for $17,348.
So second.
Got a motion by Buzzio and a second by Commissioner Langley. All those in favor, raise your right hand. All those opposed, signal. Told Hood during the break, do like this.
I have a reason I can explain it if anybody wants me to.
Okay, we're down to originally item number one, and Christina, we'll let you come up here and do the reclassification of a position.
Good evening, Commissioners. What I have before you is regarding a new position that was approved during the fiscal year 16-17 budget. If you will recall, a new position was approved for the Water Department. This position was, we spoke about the need for a position to be in charge and to develop a flushing program and to be in charge of the maintenance of the distribution system for the water system. Everyone notices the condition of our hydrants. We spoke about the importance of a flushing program. Within the past couple of years, we've been utilizing distribution mechanics to go out and to flush during the evening hours. You'll see the trucks out. That's something that we've just started. So this position would be a person that would be working under limited supervision that would be in charge of that and doing that. We spoke about the responsibilities of that. However, when I actually prepared the documents in the budget, I classified that position as a senior distribution mechanic. As you all know, my background is in private industry. I was not aware of the strict requirements of public classification and the personnel, the way that personnel or their titles are used. So when we went to advertise for this position and fill this position, I was notified by the Human Resources Department that I was unable to assign those duties to that job title. So what I'm asking tonight is that we create a new position which would still have the same duties that we spoke about during the budget process. Eric Jennings, the Water Resources Manager, and I, what we did, we went through and created a very detailed job description, which you will also see in your agenda packet. Human Resources reviewed this. Ms. Kreisman submitted that to the MAPS group, which is a human resources consultant that the county uses. So we received her input, and as you see, we are requesting that this job title now be entitled a water quality technician.
Motion to approve.
Got a motion to approve the recommendation. Is there a second?
Second.
I got a motion by Commissioner Langley and a second by Commissioner Evans. All those in favor of the motion?
Of course.
Okay.
I think you said this wasn't going to cost any more money, just a reclassification.
No additional money out of this current budget year. There will be.
That's what I wanted to say.
Mm-hmm. There he is. next budget year, it is an increase. The grade is an increase from a grade 11 to a grade 14.
Okay. It's one of them change orders, ain't it?
It's not a change order, but it is an increase in a grade. There will be an increase.
Okay, thank you.
Anybody else have any comment, question?
No.
Okay. All those in favor, raise your right hand. 7-0.
Thank you.
Thank you, Christina. All right. Health Department walk-in trail, James Mattis. Mattson.
Mr. Chairman, Board of Commissioners, how y'all doing? Before I get started on this, I just wanted to let you know that the Health Department will be going through accreditation tomorrow and the next day, so we're going to have a bunch of visitors in the Health Department checking to make sure that the Health Department is doing what we're supposed to be doing, following procedures. And if you work at a hospital, you know our Joint Commission is a very similar process. So I won't be sleeping much tonight. I'm trying to do last-minute things, but anyway, I got good staff there, so we should do fine. What I'm going to ask you about right now is permission basically to put up a healthy walking trail around the Old County Home area. And maybe you may not know this, but the state gives the health department about $4,000 a year. That's called Healthy Communities money. And what we do is we look for projects that are health related. Like in the past, we've bought school balls and stuff like that for the Boys and Girls Club. We helped build some cover over some dugouts to keep the sun from beating down on the kids when they're playing ball, you know, for prevention of skin cancer and those kind of things. So that money is there, and that's what I would propose to use. I'm figuring it's going to run about $800. It's a real simple trail. It's going to be mostly, it's going to be marked. We're not going to really do much construction. There will be probably about five or six, up to 10 stations that will be put there for suggestions on stretching and different types of exercise you can do while you're walking around there. The place we're talking about is about a little over a quarter mile, and then if you take in the consideration of the lap around the health department parking lot as one thing, you're talking about almost about a mile's worth of walking and structure. It's not going to be anything permanent. It'll be pretty it'll be easy to move if y'all plan on building or doing something else with that land later on. And so that's what I'm proposing for us to do.
Questions? Motion?
So moved.
Got a motion by Commissioner Booth. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Buzzio. Any questions? Not? All those in favor, raise your right hand. 7-0.
Thank you, money.
You want to move into your next item?
Yes, sir. Let's see. The next item is to move forward with the service expansion business plan that I brought to your attention last meeting. And just to recap, that is an expansion effort to do jail health for the county and to do some healthy living clinic services in the county. Most of those clinic services will be around prevention in nature, tobacco cessation, diabetes prevention, diabetes self-management, weight loss, and nutrition therapy, and travel medicine, those kind of things. Chief Rose is here because he's from the jail, so if there's he has a comment or two to make about the jail health.
Mr. Chairman, if I may.
Yes, sir.
I asked for Lieutenant Catherine Bryan, who is behind me, to be at the meeting tonight. Just if I could, just for the purposes of the commissioners and for the public, just wanted to give a brief introduction to her. Catherine's been with us for about 18 months now and has done an absolutely tremendous job in her role as jail administrator for Beaufort County. She has a history of working with the Jailers Association and in her past capacity with their county, took them from a transition from having a jail in a lot of ways like ours and bringing them up to speed and when it comes to the local regulations, state and federal laws. So we are very fortunate to have her. I asked her to come along today so she can field any questions that specifically go towards any of the jail health issues that you might have any questions about. I'm just fortunate that she was willing and able to be here tonight, but I just wanted to make that introduction.
Catherine, if you will, does anybody have any questions?
Yeah, I got one.
Okay.
Have you addressed the problem that we got with direct sunlight for the jail? Have you thought about that at all?
Let's keep the discussion on the agenda item and then we'll come back. Is that okay?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. Any questions as it relates to the health department taking over?
And Chairman, if I may, again, I know that Mr. Madsen had a presentation that he was going to put forward, you know, with that covered everything. I just wanted to make an introduction before you guys got two questions to let you know that she was here. And anything that could be fielded, if it can't be fielded by Mr. Madsen or myself, that we've got the foremost expert in our agency that can do that. So.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I have a question. With the switchover from the current contractor, who's out of state, I assume, correct? they provide now, what's the current service they provide?
You're talking about Southern Commissioner, Mr. Vice Commissioner, thank you for having me. Currently, we use Southern Health Partners as our contractor for inmate medical care. They
a little closer to the mic.
They subcontract to a mental health provider, so we provide mental health to the inmates. We provide medications, which is also a subcontractor to Southern Health Partners, and we provide what is ordered by law as far as health care goes to the inmates through that contractor. And yes, sir, they are based out of Tennessee.
So currently, they are providing a physician's assistant part-time? They're part-time, aren't they?
We have a physician's assistant who comes twice a month for less than a half an hour.
Okay.
From Craven County.
So in if medication currently has to be given to the inmates, who provides that medication to them when these people aren't on site?
Well, prior to about a year ago, commissioners, my staff was delivering that medication half the time because we had limited nursing coverage. We came to you last year and asked for an expansion so that we could increase the amount of nursing coverage. So the nurses are there 7 days a week, 12 hours a day, and they provide those medications within those hours. So my staff is out of that part of it.
Is that being provided by the county now, that
no,
service?
Sir. It's all under Southern Health Partners.
By the subcontract, by the contract.
So the increase that you gave us last year went okay. to Southern Health Partners.
Thank you. So, Jim, with the new system now, we're going to see an improvement in the service at a less cost, and the money's going to stay here in the county.
We do project we're going to do it for less money, but a lot of the cost is going to be realized in the future because of the relationship that we'll have. Right now, when the jail has a client that they're questioning whether they need medical care, a lot of times it's just a conversation, take them to the emergency room. And what we think is that the relationship will be a little bit closer, since we're both from the same county, that we will be able to triage a little bit better and to prevent them from having to go to that. So that's some of the savings that we're looking at there. Okay. I think we're providing it for cheaper cost, but we are not sure exactly how much the outside referral part is going to be at this point, because we're not going to do mental health. So they'll still have to send people in for specialty care. If you have an inmate with heart disease or heart problem, they're still going to have to go see specialty care. And they do that with a separate fund now as well. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. So basically, what you both of you are saying is that from a subcontractor, we're going to go and do the service ourselves at your department at less cost. The money's going to stay here in the county, and the service is going to be increased.
Yes, sir.
Basically.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I have some questions. Go ahead. Let him go ahead.
She stated that you have a nurse there 7 days a week at 12 hours a day. Now, when this go away, what kind of coverage are you going to have on site to calculate those hours?
Do you want to speak to that, Jim?
Well, it's going to be, I guess at this point, same nursing coverage. It'll be 7 days a week, 12 hours.
Are you going to contract with this nursing company, or is it going to be somebody from your staff?
It'll be staff, three staff. We're talking about hiring three, an RN and two LPNs.
Okay.
Staff it.
And doing these 12, they did 7-12. What happens to the somebody gets sick after? Are they rotating schedule, or did they just from 7-12 hours and go home? Is it a rotating schedule?
I'm looking at a schedule where their weekend will be part of their coverage.
Okay.
So you'll have the RN probably be there the Monday through Friday job,
okay.
working most of the assessment parts where they're assessing the health conditions of the inmates, and if they want to go on sick call. So they'll take care of that part, and then the LPNs will be covering more of the later evening shifts, which is mostly going to be medicine distribution, and then the weekend coverage.
Okay. So it'll be the same
right.
coverage.
I think one of the places that's really going to increase in coverage is going to be the fact that our provider, in our proposal, the nurse practitioner, the PA, or a physician, whichever one I'm able to get, the coverage is going to be once a week.
Okay.
They'll be in the jail for up to 4 hours, whatever it takes in order to do the intake assessments, because when the client comes in, or the inmate comes in, they have to have a full physical done within 20 within 2 weeks. They have to have an assessment within the first 24 hours, but then they have a full physical within 2 weeks.
This is something. Go ahead.
Can I expand on that just a
yes.
bit? Currently, how we're positioned, we have nursing there for 12 hours a day. Our provider works at a prison in Craven. Our provider meaning doctor, physician's assistant. So he's unavailable by phone to the nurses. So if they get anything in front of them that is outside the scope of their license, whether it's an RN license or an LPN license, our default is to send them to the emergency room. My previous facility, we had arrangements with physicians in the community or in urgent care where we could take them before we had to go to the emergency room, before we had to put them in an ambulance at a cost, go to the emergency room with all the ancillary costs of a deputy to transport and man hours in the emergency room. We have no other choice right now other than to send them to the emergency room. What the director is saying is because we would closely work together, two county agencies in partnership, in business to do what we're supposed to do, not in business for profit, we're kind of at cross odds. We don't currently have a problem with Southern Health Partners. They provide an excellent service, but they're in the business, they're a for-profit business. So our mission statements look a little bit different. If we partner with the health department, our mission statements are in alignment because we're two county entities with common missions. The provider would be available much more to the nursing staff, and he would work with the nursing, or he or she would work so closely with the nursing staff that we project that we would send them out to the emergency room less. There are the unexpected catastrophic costs that we just all wait and hope against. That won't change. A heart attack is a heart attack is a heart attack, no matter who's providing her cost. But the health department, with their public health component and their prevention component, we project would help us have healthier inmates and maybe prevent that catastrophic event and be able to have more of a conversation to us. Because they're a private company, a lot of what they do is not transparent to me as the administrator, which causes me some anxiety. With the health department, that would be different. So we would be able to co-manage the inmates.
And just a couple other things to piggyback onto that with is by having the provider into this service and then under a contract with us to provide this service, we'll be able to use that provider in our healthy living clinic arena, which offers us the opportunity to bill for those services. So that opens up the opportunity to bring in more billable services, the money, the revenue that's generated by that, because we have a provider actually on staff then with the health department. So it serves as a double function by having that capacity. And then we also think that as a public health aspect to this is that we're interested in the health of those inmates when they get out of their confinement. And we want to make sure that when they do get back into the society that they are healthy and they know where to go for the services that could help the general public as a whole.
Yeah, I have some questions. How many inmates do you have now that are on prescription drugs?
Commissioner Richardson, we average about 20 inmates on any given day.
That are on prescription drugs?
Yes, sir.
When they arrive at the jail, they're on prescription drugs?
Some when they arrive and some that are prescribed once they're in. We have a population that is not the healthiest on the outside for a variety of reasons, economic reasons, transportation reasons, a variety of reasons. So just because they're not on medication on the outside, when we receive them and they go through the medical process, there are times that we prescribe then.
I understood that we were triaging new inmates to make sure that we didn't take in high-risk inmates. By that, I mean that we find a way that we don't have to have them in jail, that they can be off taking care of themselves. We don't do that?
We're required by law to take the inmates when they come.
No, that's not what I said. Once you've taken the inmate, the inmates are assessed, and if you have high-risk inmates that are there on minor charges or even major charges, that we look for alternatives so that they don't have to be in jail.
That is correct. And the major alternative is to house them in the prison system in a safekeeping bed. There are only two.
No, you misunderstood again. What we're doing, see, we have the ankle bracelet program that they could be put on if they are a high health risk, so that burden does not fall on Beaufort County. There are certain people who have mental cases that we don't want in jail to begin with. Now, so what you're telling me is you're not doing your screening.
No. Mr. Chairman, if I'm
go ahead.
What Lieutenant Bryan's saying and what I'm going to say right now is that if there is an opportunity that we have by law to decrease the population in the jail, then we do that. But there are certain things that go on that we are legally obligated to take care of, and if a judge deems that person is to be incarcerated, then there is nothing that anybody, to include the jail administrator or I or the sheriff themselves, are going to change that. The pretrial release program is one of those, that we have tried to utilize that as much as we can. But if we do not get a Superior Court judge's signature, then that person does not go on pretrial release. You know, there's plenty of other things that I can say that, you know, as far as health care issues, that we would love for the person not to be incarcerated in our jail. But if the alternative is for us to break the law by them not being incarcerated, then that's not an alternative.
Okay. Cite the law for me that says that they have to have a physical if they've been in jail 2 weeks.
There is no law, Commissioner.
I thought I heard you say they had to have a physical in 2 weeks.
I said that. That was my mistake then.
Oh, so now we're taking on the health care of everybody that we can take on. Gee, this is something that we just don't. This is an added expense.
Commissioner, if you let me finish, I'll answer your question, sir.
Mm-hmm. Well, finish.
We are required by law to provide health care to inmates. We're required by law to have a medical plan that provides for the screening of communicable diseases and chronic problems. The 14 days is a best practice given by a private company that accredits certain jails and clinics. We are not accredited. We've adopted that best practice because that's what Southern Health Partners does at this time, but there is no law that says 14 days.
Okay, so we're imposing our own rules on how we're going to provide this health care in the jail.
Answer that, yes, we are. Because we are doing what's in the best practice and what's in the best purposes for. I'm sorry, excuse me. Yes, we are making policies, procedures, and protocols. Because it is our responsibility as working for the sheriff and the sheriff's office to do as much as we can to make the people that we have in our charge okay. We are not looking to solve all of their problems and their issues, but we are looking to try to mitigate as much as we can to try to get the sheriff and the sheriff's office out of the way of any problems that could arise by us failing to act. So yes, we are making our own rules, procedures, and protocols based on industry's best practices, based on statutes, and based on other laws.
Well, I understand that, but what I'm not hearing that I would like to hear is someone saying something like, we need to have a screening process, and we need to work with the various agencies so that we can get more of these people out of jail so that the taxpayers don't have to pay for them.
Now, once again on that, I think we're talking about completely separate issues.
Yes, we are.
The rule of the jail, I mean, if there is any doubt at all that the justice system is a system that's set up to punish people, that is what that is. Our part is the jail, and I will let the jail administrator speak to that. Our job when it comes to that piece of it is that we are supposed to safely house inmates that are waiting for their day in court or that may have received their day in court and are going through the sentences of that. So we are fully aware of the laws and responsibilities that we are under, and we are trying to do the best thing for the citizens of Beaufort County, for the sheriff's office, and for the commissioners. You know, in this project that we're talking about, which we haven't even really started to discuss all of the benefits of this, we're just sticking on the jail piece. is that, yes, there are a lot of things that we are going to be doing, and all of those things are based on some sort of fact, not just some sort of ideas on that these things are the best thing for Beaufort County and the jail in Beaufort County to be doing.
Well, you're talking about the care that's given to prisoners. I'm talking about how do we eliminate having the prisoners to begin with, and there are ways to do that, but I'm not hearing anyone from the sheriff's office say, you could lighten our load if we could get with the mental health people, this, yeah, that, and the other. And some of these people could be released that really don't need to be in jail other than they don't have the money to make bail.
If you can come up with a solution for the question that you just posed and bottle it, then the whole world would be seeking your advice on that.
Well, but you had the people here a year
county,
and a half ago. I met with them.
Yeah, absolutely. And we, as an agency, are going through the process and trying to adopt as many of their procedures and protocols as we can as an agency. But as far as the board, that is left to the board to decide what direction the board and the county is going to move on with some of those recommendations. But as far as crime and criminal activity, as far as the things that we take a part of, as far as that part of the system, that has nothing to do with the discussion that Director Madsen and Lieutenant Bryan are talking about. That has to do with the system as a whole. If you would like to fix the justice system, please, by all means, do that. But right now we're talking about jail health and the business expansion plan from the health department.
Well, Chief Rose, I'm waiting on your written recommendations on how to do what you just described, that we had the federal people come here a year and a half ago, and I haven't seen any recommendations from your department. So when are you going to produce them?
I work for...
Let's get back to the change that we're talking about.
All right, I have another question.
Okay. Is it pertaining to the new plan?
You have to ask that?
I mean, if it's about changing the judicial system, yeah.
I'm not talking about changing the judicial system.
Go ahead.
The method of payments for the agreement that we have with Southern Health, do we pay them so much a quarter or so much a month as a fixed fee? And how do the additional fees apply?
We pay them monthly, Commissioner.
Okay.
What additional fees are you referring to?
What do we pay them for monthly?
Pay them for the nursing coverage, we pay them for the subcontractor, we pay their profit margin, we pay the provider. All of that is lumped into their contract. And I'm baffled, Commissioner, when we presented this at the health board meeting, of which you're a part, none of these questions came up, sir. We could have been talking about this, because I love to educate about the jail and legal requirements. I love to give you all the best information that I can and be a good steward of county money that I have a track record of doing, and mitigating the exposure to liability, which I have a track record of doing. And we could have talked about this over the last several months, and I'd have been glad to answer these questions and provide you with the resources, the legal background for this.
Well, I believe I told you at that time, and I'll tell you again, this is a really bad idea. The county has no control over these costs, because once it becomes internal to the county, we just keep writing checks to the health department. They just keep spending money. We've lost all control of our budget. So I'm going to go back to how we pay. Do we have an additional fee for the drugs? Do we pay an additional fee for drugs that are prescribed?
Out of our contract, total contract cost is a cost pool. Up to $40,000 for a cost pool. A certain percentage of that, they pay 100%. A higher percentage of that, we pay 50%. After a certain amount of money, we pay 100% of that cost pool, out of which the medications come.
That's for drugs, or is that for drugs plus professional care?
Medications and outside services.
So we pay a base plus that schedule that you just gave me.
That is included in the base. That is included in the total contract cost.
What about the mental health? Is that included in the total contract?
That's all included.
That contract never came to the commissioners to be approved. We've been into this before where contracts are supposed to come to commissioners to be approved. Because I would remember it. We've got people, again, and I don't fuss about this, that are out signing contracts that the commissioners don't know what they're getting and don't know what they're signing. So I'm making a request right now to be on the agenda for the next meeting that those contracts be produced for all of the commissioners. And I'm also making a second request that what it's cost us for the last year be produced, the surcharges and all of the other things, because this needs to be looked at. Now, if there's a lawsuit, let's say that we don't give adequate care or somebody's unhappy and he goes to a lawyer and he decides to sue under the present system, who does he sue?
It is absolutely common that the lawsuit goes to both the sheriff's office as the steward of the jail and the county commissioners and the contractor.
Okay, who's the first line of pay?
It depends on whether it's a state case or a 1983 case that goes to federal court.
What do you mean, a state case or a 1983
case? They can sue if we violated their state rights. They can also sue if we violated their federal rights. In our current facility, we violate their constitutional rights daily, as I've reported in my state of the jail address.
How do we do that?
Lock them up.
When you kill that motion to build a jail.
How do we do that?
I would refer you to the state of the jail reports that I've written every year that I've been here.
I haven't seen those. Those don't come to commissioners.
Why
don't
they do?
Why don't they come to... Her state of the jail report hasn't come to us.
I got it.
Why don't I get them?
I've emailed both of those documents to the same email address that I email every other thing that you ask for from us.
His Obama phone won't get
me. I don't remember getting those. Those should be a part of the of this. This should be a part of this agenda book so it can be considered by commissioners. Now, under the new system, who's going to be sued if somebody decides to sue for medical care?
Litigants won't change, Commissioner.
No, no. Who is the suit going to be directed against?
Again, the litigants won't change. It will be you and the sheriff's office and the health department. But I'll tell you who it won't be mostly of is the sheriff's office because of those state of jail addresses. We've highlighted what the problems are. They'll be reflected in requests. And when they're denied, I have closed the exposure to my boss, which is my responsibility.
Okay, I'd like in the agenda book for the next meeting all of her reports.
They've been in there in the information booklets that you received.
We got one.
All right, I want them again.
Right now.
I want them again.
I got one right now.
Because they weren't represented as that way.
And as now, liability from the health department stance is we already have liability insurance that we're covered under for procedures and stuff that we do in the health department. So it would fall under the same contract. We got a quote from our insurer that it would be an additional $2,700, I can't remember the exact number, for the year on top of that for the liability insurance.
Only that amount additional?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, may I make one more comment?
We've got some other people up here that's ready to ask some questions, and you may get asked a question. I don't know. But Commissioner Brin?
Minister Cap, now this question's for you. We were talking about drugs a few minutes ago and how they're prescribed when they come into the jail. If a prisoner is brought in and he's on some type of opioid or something like that, how do you get him off of that, or do you keep prescribing for him if he has a prescription for it? How exactly does that work?
Yes, sir. Currently, Southern Health Partners' policy is that we're a limited narcotic facility. So only under very limited cases would they continue a narcotic. They have protocols in place for substitutions for that.
Gradually.
Anything fancier than that, I'm not going to be able to answer your question.
Well, if you'll prescribe antibiotics and things like that, if they become sick after they're in there. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Prescribe me some, please.
You got to go in there.
Go on, Lord. Hey,
get
charges.
Get him,
Rose. Get him. Lock him up.
Thank you, Chairman.
Commissioner Evans.
I've toured a lot of the county so far, but I've heard about you and all good things. So I'd like to come down
Please
through
do.
The jail sometime,
Please
see the
do.
Protocol. So it makes sense to me. Reports make sense.
Yes, sir. We'd love to.
I've heard is just nothing but top notch. You've answered the question, and I thank you for the job.
Thank
it's a tough, tough, tough job in a tough place.
I don't want to see it.
I don't either.
I'll be there.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
I've seen enough of it.
Does any of the other commissioners have any
No, Lord.
Okay. Do you still want to say something? If you do, you can step up here, Charlie.
Don't say it.
Any of the procedures as far as purchasing, as far as contracts, or anything that goes between our office and the finance office, we go by the rules and the protocols that are put forth by the commissioners. Now, I will fully say that in a lot of cases that we are more aware of what the rules are when it comes to purchasing than perhaps you are. And that is okay, but if you need more than my assurance on that, please by all means speak to the county office and the finance office. If it needs to be pre-audited, it's pre-audited. If it needs to be signed by the manager, it's signed by the manager. All of the rules that you put in place for us to do financially, we take care of and then some. And that's all I wanted to say.
James, did you want to say anything else?
He started.
He's waiting for his motion.
Yeah.
Well, I thought we were ready. Have we not had a motion, Katie?
Nope. Oh. Certainly have not.
Okay.
Okay, well, I guess what I'll read in the motion I had written in here. So it is recommended that the Board of County Commissioners approve the Health Department to serve as the health care provider for the jail and to initiate the Healthy Living Clinic services. This would include support to reallocate county funds from the current budget line in the Sheriff's Office to a new cost center in the Health Department's budget. Further, the Health Department will be allowed to staff the program with up to 3 nursing assistant full-time equivalents and to receive funds to secure a medical provider. The support of the board is based on not exceeding the service expansion business plan budget that was given to you on 3 January 2017.
So moved.
Got a motion by Commissioner Wren, second by Commissioner Buzzio. All those in favor of the motion.
Whoa, discussion.
And we already discussed
that. No, you've had it. You've got a motion. The rules require discussion if a commissioner wants to comment. Now, let me tell you what this is about, for those of you that don't know. This is about adding more employees to the county payroll, a doctor and 3 nurses, possibly some clerical help. And so you've already got 350 or 351 employees. You're adding some more employees to this. You're going to pay for this. You know, they're trying to make you think that this is break even. You're going to lose control of the services that are provided to jail inmates, because right now we're providing only what's required by law. These guys have already said, oh, we want to help these people get back on their feet. You're going to be running a social program in the jail through the health department. There's a difference between public health and private or personal health. Public health are things that affect everybody that no one of us can do anything about. Typhoid fever, tuberculosis, things like that. Private health is, I heard over here at my side, what can you do about it? Shoot. We don't need to get into the business. The county does not need to get into the business of providing more private health to the public. The doctors are out there and the hospitals are out there that provide that. You as taxpayers do not need to start competing with them with another social program that is going to only cost you money before it is over with. So this is a really, really bad idea.
Is there anyone else that would like to say anything before we take a vote? Okay, being none, all those in favor of the expansion, raise your right hand. All those opposed, and I saw it, and the vote is 6-1. Thank you very much. And we invite you to come back at another meeting.
No.
That was yesterday.
It was very nice to meet you for the first time.
Okay. The next item is the patrol vehicle purchase with insurance funds, Chief Charlie Rose.
Well, it's been about 15 minutes since we've talked about a patrol car, so I figured it's probably about time to do that. The information that you have in front of you is, in essence, what we're looking to do is we had two motor vehicle collisions late 2016. That was at no fault of the deputies that were driving the vehicle, one of which was me, that we lost two vehicles. We had two vehicles get totaled. One was a Dodge Charger. The other was a Ford F-150. The money that we received back from insurance was in the amount of $38,425.23. We would like to, for approval, to use those funds to replace one patrol vehicle. We would like to replace the F-150 now. The cost of the vehicle and upfitting and everything involved is going to be slightly less, within $1,000 or less than the appropriated amount through insurance. So there's not going to be an additional cost of general fund dollars for this. The reason that we chose the F-150 is that the utility that we get from those vehicles, especially during storms, bad weather, if we need to move something around, it is a burden on us when we do not have the ability to have vehicles such as that. The vehicle that was totaled was a 2005 and was on the list for us to replace this last year or the next year anyway, so that's the one that we're looking to move. If there's any questions, I'll fill them if I can.
Okay, we're going to do this a little bit different. We're going to take a motion and a second, and then we'll have our questions and discussion.
So moved.
No, second.
Got a motion by Commissioner Evans and a second by Commissioner Brand. All right, now, questions, comments, discussion?
Do I have some comments?
Go ahead.
Well, you know, looking at the schedule that they gave us, there's 66 vehicles that are assigned in the department. This is all the way from a magistrate who uses it to do nothing but come and go to work. And there's 9 surplus vehicles by my count listed now. Surplus cars, they already have 4 surplus cars. So if you've got 66 assigned vehicles and 9 surpluses, you really don't need to buy another vehicle. So I'm not going to vote for this.
Any other comments? Okay. All those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. All those opposed? 6-1. You want to go into your next one?
Sure. Over the past year and a half, we've at the sheriff's office, we've been looking at the military vehicles that we have through the 1033 program. In years past, you know, you would recognize them as being in the parking lot for over a dozen years. We had a 1968 deuce and a half truck, and then we had a 1984 Humvee. Those were the two vehicles that we had. About a year and a half ago, almost 2 years ago, we decided through looking through what vehicles are available, because there's been a massive influx of vehicles that have been moved from overseas back to the states, and they're now in surplus. We were looking to update the vehicles that we had. We have done that. The commissioners have been notified through emails and different things when opportunities would come up. The two vehicles, because we're looking to keep two, we can, during storms and other events like that, we can put 2 or 3 deputies on each, and that's about all of the military vehicles that we need to be able to fully utilize and to keep them up to operational standards that we need to keep them. We've been able to upgrade the vehicles that we have, which now you can see in the parking lot. We've got, they're still deuce and a halves. There's one of them is a 1995 Stewart and Stevenson, the other is a 1997 Stewart and Stevenson. That they've afforded us a lot more capabilities. They're a lot more maneuverable. That we can put them into all of the places that we need to, whether it's high water or snow or any other event, drug eradication, search and rescue, any of those events, those vehicles are ideal for. With that being said, right now we've got 3 that are on our books. We're able to get the Humvee that we had back to the 1033 program, and then they very quickly got it to Greene County, who is now using that Humvee. The deuce and a half, we tried a couple of different ways. We reached out to the local fire departments, local municipalities that could possibly use that truck, and we got some responses back from that. After some discussion with several of the fire departments, it was decided amongst them that Clark's Neck Fire Department would be the recipient of that, and so we're presenting that to you today, because we would need approval from the board for that vehicle to be transitioned from the sheriff's office care to Clark's Neck Fire Department, where that they go through the same issues and the same areas that they've got within their fire district. That is, a deuce and a half is ideal for them in search and rescue and high water and things of that nature.
So moved.
Got a motion by Commissioner Booth.
Second.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Buzzio. Questions, comments, discussion? If none, all those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. 7-0. Thank you. Martin, we're back to you. And you're going to put a fence up. Is that right?
Well, not me. Not me. The AAF Flanders, Flanders, who was recently bought by AAF, wants to put a security fence around their property, starting at the sides of the building and then going all the way around the property. It will be controlled with electric gates and things like that to allow access. The covenants in the industrial park request that they provide a plan of what they propose to do, and also a picture, and I believe you have that in your handouts. The City of Washington has reviewed the plan and the fence picture, and they've determined that there's no permit required. The only request they make is that it does not obstruct the view for ingress and egress of the property. And obviously, given it's in line with the building, there is no none of that at the driveways onto Page Road. Covenants refer to the Beaufort County Economic Development Commission, which was dissolved in 2012. So that is why coming to the county board to approve this fence be built. So the motion would be to pass a motion in support. Oh, also it went to the Beaufort County Economic Development Advisory Board. So please pass a motion in support of the Beaufort County Economic Development Advisory recommendation that the AAF Flanders solution be allowed to install the security fence as outlined in the plan.
Entertain a motion.
So moved. Move.
Got a motion by Commissioner Brand and a second by Commissioner Evans. Questions? Comments?
No cost to...
No. No.
All those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. 7-0.
Thank you. Thank you.
You want to continue?
If that's the pleasure of the board.
Yes.
Okay. As I just stated, the covenants for the Washington Beaufort County Industrial Park state in several places, in fact 15 times within the document, they refer to the Beaufort County Economic Development Commission, which, as I just stated, was dissolved in 2012, and the Beaufort County Economic Development Advisory Board was created. So to improve the efficiency and review of requests like you just received, where it seems time-consuming for the occupants of the park to have to come to the County Board of Commissioners, the Beaufort County Economic Development Advisory Board would like to have the covenant amended to replace wherever it says Beaufort County Economic Development Commission, it say Beaufort County Economic Development Board. All the companies in the park have signed on the document, as it needs 90% of the property owners to approve such a change to the covenants. And now it, oh, and also the Committee of 100, since they own the Skills Center. So right now, just the approval of the county and the city are needed to make this change. So the request is that the county commissioners amend the covenants, the Washington Beaufort County Industrial Park, to read Beaufort County Economic Development Advisory Board rather than Beaufort County Economic Development Commission, wherever it is stated, and that documents be recorded to that effect.
You've heard the recommendation. Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Commissioner Buzzio made the motion, and Commissioner Evans second. Questions? Comments? Hearing none. All those in favor, raise your right hand. 7-0.
Thank you.
That's your last one, isn't it?
Yeah.
We're down to reconciliation of the Washington Beaufort County Industrial Park financing. Brian.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Members of the board, taking you back to the industrial park. You've got a letter that's attached from the city manager regarding the reconciliation of the interlocal agreement that the county and the city entered into back in 2001. You also have a copy of that agreement that's attached. Essentially, as part of that agreement, when that property was purchased, the city and the county partnered on purchasing that property. As part of that agreement, the city made 32 quarterly payments to the county, which equaled 45% of the cost of purchasing that property. That agreement also went on to say if property were sold in the park during that financing period, which was 2002 to 2009, that the term or the amount of the remaining payments from the city would be adjusted or could be adjusted to take up that difference. Records that we have and records from the city indicate that they made all 32 payments. We did, and there was no adjustment in any of the term or the amount. We've looked at the closing statements. The city attorneys looked at the closing statements. The county attorneys looked at the closing statements. And it's our best reconciliation that based on properties that were sold during that time period and there was no adjustment made, that the county owes the city $30,776.98 for that final reconciliation. And we make that recommendation to you, and there's a budget amendment attached with it. Take any questions you may have.
You've heard the recommendation from the county manager. That I have a motion?
So moved.
Motion by Commissioner Langley. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Evans. Questions? Discussion? You did a good job, Brian. All those in favor of the budget change, raise your right hand. 7-0. Okay, we're down to item number 10, I guess it's 11 now. Request for proposed language for recall elections, Commissioner Richards.
I'll make the same motion that I've been making before, and that is that this Board of County Commissioners instruct our legislative delegation to provide us with language having to do with the recall of county commissioners. This is something that the legislature can do, and all we have to do is ask for it. So I make that request. I make that motion.
And I'm going to do just like I did last.
Okay, we've got a motion on the floor as it pertains to recall elections. Is there a second to the motion? No second, so motion dies. We're down to disposition of legal files with Smith, Moore, and Leatherwood. Brian.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. You've got a letter that's attached that came from Smith, Moore, Leatherwood LLP regarding the departure of Aaron Roberts, who's an attorney with them. Ms. Roberts served as the county's attorney during the process by which the hospital lease agreement, when you sold the hospital, entered the lease agreement with Viaduct, went through all that process, and she has continued on in assisting the county from the county's perspective in interpreting that lease and how that lease works with the hospital. So she again has left and has joined Nelson Mullins Riley Scarborough. And anytime an attorney leaves, you get a letter from that firm saying, do you want us to retain your files regarding those projects, or do you want them to go with the attorney? Our recommendation to you is that those files go with her and that you continue your relationship with her as the attorney who has handled those projects for you in the past.
You've heard the recommendation as it pertains to the legal files. Can I have a motion?
I'll make the motion, Mr. Chairman.
Got a motion by Commissioner Evans and a second by Commissioner Buzzio. All those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. All those opposed, 6-1. Okay, we're down to item number 12 or 13, disposition of real property. Brian?
There are three separate county-owned parcels that
we're in. Can I ask the board for one thing?
Yes, sir.
Excuse me. I would like to break this into two votes. I can vote for the first one. The second one is the one that I have a conflict of interest.
That's all.
That's fine with me.
That's fine.
Okay, so regarding parcel number one and parcel number two, just a little bit of background. As we've been instructed by the board, we are taking every opportunity we can to find county-owned parcels and try to get them back on private tax rolls. The GIS department has put together a book that we have with all the county properties. We're trying to get that out. One of our first things that we do is we look for parcels that are owned by the county that are surrounded by other folks. And we reach out to those folks and say, here's a piece of property that the county owns. We're trying to get back on the rolls. Are you interested in that piece of property? This is an example of two of those pieces. These pieces are actually surrounded by Potash Corporation property. So we reached out to Potash and said, you know, these are surrounded by you already. Would you like to purchase those? They said that they would like to do that. You can see that one of those parcels is 0.24 acres and is listed on the tax value for $64. The second is 0.38 acres and is listed on the tax value as $1,333. They have agreed to that. They said they would pay us tax value for it. It helps clean stuff up for us, and it helps them not have pieces of stray property within their borders. Our recommendation to you is that you proceed under the negotiated offer and upset bid process, which is GS 168-269, to allow us to dispose of that. We would receive a formal quote from, or a formal agreement offer. Thank you, David. Offer from Potash, and we would advertise that as we do under the statute for a 10-day period for upset, and then we would close on if we didn't receive that. So we make that recommendation for you on parcel number one and number two.
So moved.
Got a motion by Commissioner Brand. Is there a second? Second by Commissioner Booth. All those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. 7-0. As it relates to this other parcel, Brian and I had some conversation this afternoon at Beaufort Community College. I really would like for somebody to volunteer to go down there with Brian, one or two of the commissioners, and take a look at this piece of property and see how close it is to the existing boat ramp. Okay, so we got, how about since you're on that side of the river? Well, all three of you.
Yeah.
As long as it's not four. Can you handle those three?
Right. Yes. Okay. It's going to be tough to serve.
And come back with some recommendation at our next meeting. Is that agreeable?
Fine with me.
Is that agreeable with you, Bud?
Well, I'm not in it since I've accused myself.
I mean, I don't know if any commissioner has ever been to this.
I haven't.
Well, for those of you that are puzzled, I can tell you what my conflict is. I've been engaged by the person who's made the offer to purchase it to do some other work for him on other properties of his. So that's a conflict.
Okay.
Can I just give you the background on it?
Yes.
It's in your agenda item. This is a piece of property that predates everybody in this room by a while. This property was, you have the transfer of property. The county purchased this property for $150 on May 22nd, 1911. And it was to be used as a public boat landing. And you see the picture of the way it's laid out. I mean, it is simply, at that time, I'm sure it was a dirt road. I doubt very seriously it was paved at that time. It may have been. I kind of doubt it. And at that time, it was just kind of, you have one of the pictures, you just pull off in there. So it's a very small parcel. It's 0.21 acres. It's listed at tax value of $2,500. There was a deed restriction that said once you acquired this property from the owner, you had to hold it for at least 25 years to be used as a public boat landing. That expired in 1936.
Jesus Christ.
Since that time, it continues. It continues to be used as a public boat landing. There are fishermen who use it. We looked at it last year. We received a comment from one of the fishermen said, you guys need to fix up the boat landing a little bit. Well, we reached out to North Carolina Wildlife because, as you know, we're really not in the boat landing business. So we reached out to North Carolina Wildlife and said, can you look at this and can you do something? Can you fix this? Can you do whatever you need to do to make this a public landing? They looked at it and said, absolutely not. It is too small. There is no parking available. The people who use it park their vehicles and trailers on the side of the state-maintained road. Their concern was that of a liability, that if they went in and did something without acquiring additional property, you're having a liability there. Because not that it's not going to happen, eventually one of these days somebody's going to step out from behind the trailer and get hit by a car, and they're going to sue Beaufort County because there's not enough room to park down there. That's our concern from staff and from the county attorney's perspective on the liability issue. So we wanted to bring this to you to say, you've got a piece of property that we've got an offer on. It is a public piece of property that people do use as a boat landing. Our perspective on that is you've got a couple options. You can say, we like it the way it is. We understand y'all believe there's some liability, but it's going to ride the way it is. If you choose to do that, that's fine. We just need for you to tell us that. The second thing you can do is sell it and get rid of it and let somebody else own it. The third thing you can do is give us some money and let us go negotiate with an adjoining property owner and ask them if we can buy some additional property so you can make a proper boat landing that wildlife would put in and look after, and there wouldn't be liability issues. So those are the three things, and we're happy to take you down there and take a look at it and come back with a recommendation from the board.
Right.
But again, there are people that use it. I'm not saying there aren't people that use it. And I know Commissioner Richardson expressed to me he thought that people would not be happy about that, and I'm sure they won't be happy about it. But from our perspective, you've either got to fix it, accept the liability that we believe exists there, or get away from it.
Why can't we just close access to it?
I mean, essentially, you would be closing access by selling it. You've got somebody who wants to buy it. And then it's their liability, not yours. I mean, I think if you went down there and put a chain across it, the chain wouldn't stay very long. But we're happy to take whoever wants to go see it and come back at the next meeting.
Take only three.
I will. At any one time, I will only take three.
Okay, Dan, to the reconciliation of the airport grant. That's you again, Brian.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You have a revised piece that I gave you this afternoon. The agenda item says reconciliation of airport grant revised 2617. The reason it's revised is there was actually an additional fiscal or actually an additional calendar tax year that wasn't included. So in January of 11, county and the city of Washington entered into an agreement, the agreement's in your agenda, that de-annexed the area inside the fence of the Washington Airport, Washington Warren Field. Just inside the fence, it was de-annexed. That was an agreement. It was done by the General Assembly as a local act to de-annex that property. It was done under an agreement between the city and the county in an effort to increase economic development and opportunities for people who had airplanes, so that they would locate there instead of locating somewhere else, because you had only half the tax burden. You only would pay county taxes and not city taxes. Well, as part of that agreement, they established what was called an airport grant. They looked at the baseline. So what they said was, in 2011, what is the baseline of the value of the property out there? Privately owned property, not publicly owned property, because the terminal and the hangars are publicly owned, so you don't pay taxes on those anyway. But the airplanes that were out there and any existing hangars that were privately owned who just had a ground lease, what was that value? And they set that value. And they said, here's the value, and that value was $1.3 million and change. And that was in 2009. So they said whatever that revenue is generated off of that came out to be $8,128. Well, that's the baseline that the county gets no matter what. So during the time period that the city now runs that place, if they increase the tax base out there, they benefit from it. The county will always get, under this agreement that the board entered into, an amount of money of $8,128. So it's a risk reward for the city to try to drive economic development, get more people to put their planes out there, get more folks to build hangars out there. It benefits them. So, and each year, we get a list from the city of the people who have aircraft out there. And we list those, and we charge them. We tax them at the county rate. But one of the things that we found was that when the solar farm was located on the airport property, it is a private, it's privately owned by public, it's a public utility. Duke Energy owns that. So it is taxed, but it is taxed by the Department of Revenue. The Department of Revenue sets the value for public service, like gas company, electric lines, railroad, those kind of things. They set that value and send it to us. Well, that value should have been captured by the county because that was an increase in value. There are taxes being paid off of it. And that should have been captured by the county in the airport grant and added to that. It wasn't. And it wasn't done that way for 2 years, 14 and 15. We have it now corrected. So for 16 tax year moving forward, we've got that right. But for 14 and 15, it wasn't. So you can see the calculation in the second paragraph that shows that the value of the solar farm in 2014, January 1 of 2014, was $948,162. They were still building it at that time. It wasn't completely built out. And that equates at 53 cents, which is what the county tax rate was at that time, $5,025.26. Then there, in 2015, the value went up to a little over $1 million because they had finally finished it and completed it. And that at 53 cents was $5,804.75. So essentially, what that means is those funds should have been transferred to the city under the airport grant. However, in 14 and 15, and it was probably because of the way it's being reported back to them under the state, it has been corrected moving forward. The solar farm company, the LLC, was charged state and was charged city and county taxes. And it should only have been charged county taxes because it was de-annexed. So there is a refund that needs to come out of that because they were never supposed to be charged city taxes to begin with, but they were. So you have the refund amounts for 2014, which would be $4,086.58, and then in 15, $4,720.47. Those are over billings, and they have to be refunded because they were improperly taxed. Now, also, because we've already transferred those funds to the city of Washington, they've got to be recaptured. The good news is you owe them money. You're taking money back. So the difference you see is that $2,022.96 is the difference. That's the net that you are due to the city of Washington under the airport grant that straightens out all the issues from 2014 and 2015, and anything moving forward now we've got fixed. So it was long and convoluted. I'll answer any questions you have, but that's our recommendation to you, and this will clear it up, and you have a budget amendment that appropriates funds to do that.
You've heard the manager's recommendation. Could I have a motion?
I'll make a motion.
Motion by Commissioner Buzzio, a second.
Langley.
Commissioner Langley. Questions? If none, all those in favor of the recommendation and the motion, raise your right hand. 7-0. Okay. Ryan, this one is yours too.
Yes, sir.
The old Ford Clark's Neck EMS contract.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. As you recall, at a regular meeting of the Board of Commissioners on October the 3rd of 16, the board voted 6-1 with Commissioner Richardson voting against to not renew the contract to the City of Washington for providing EMS services in the Old Ford in the Washington Township, which includes Old Ford and Clark's Neck fire districts, and instead providing those EMS services in that area with county personnel. I've attached for you a copy of that agenda item, which listed out the discussion that occurred or the information that was provided in that October meeting. As you're aware, since that vote, there's been both support for the measure. There's been concern expressed for the measure from different residents in different areas of the service district. As a response to that, the EMS committee, which is made up of county and city representatives, continued to meet and discuss the issue. At its most recent meeting on January the 6th of this year, A proposal was provided, an alternate proposal was put in place for consideration to provide a county QRV, quick response vehicle, in the service area and continue the contract with the city. The effort to do that was so that the folks that were far out in the district would have a quicker response by an ALS level provider, and then the folks who were closer to the city would still have that close response by the city. As you're aware, wherever you move things, there are going to be pluses and minuses. This was an attempt to try to take into those two into consideration. The proposal, which we've attached as well, because the board said we have committed to spend $121,000 in general fund money to put an ambulance, a physical ambulance, at Old Ford to provide coverage in that area. Our assumption was that was about as far as you wanted to go. So we took the 121 and said, how do you put a QRV in place and continue the contract and still only spend 121? To do that, you've got to reduce the contract amount you would be paying to the city to provide that coverage. And essentially, that was about $100,000. So under that proposal, the EMS committee looked at it at the last meeting. We said, the city has said, if you take all of that, then there's about a $300,000 downside to our budget. This proposal, the downside is about $100,000. That was presented to the EMS advisory committee. They looked at it. There wasn't any action taken by it. There was discussion, but there wasn't any action taken back. So what we're doing is bringing that to you for your consideration. If you feel you want to make any changes to the existing action that you took in October, because currently you have an action that you've taken in place that says you're out of the contract, you're going to do it yourself. There hasn't been a vote taken by this board to change that or do away with that. So if you want to make a change to that, what we need, and the city has expressed the same concern. We're all going into budget. We need to know where we are, and we need to start moving forward. There's also a 90-day out on that contract. If I don't write them the letter officially and say, on October the 3rd, 2016, the Board of Commissioners voted at a regular meeting to discontinue this contract. If I don't do that within 90 days of the contract ending, then it automatically renews. So we need to go ahead. The board needs to decide what they want to do. And the city, again, has expressed the same thing. We just need to know. So I'll be glad to go over the options again, or I'll let y'all discuss that and you tell us what direction you'd like for us to take.
Have you received any conversation from the city since you had the meeting, the EMS?
I have not. Okay. Not had any additional conversation with
them. Has the other members?
No.
I'd
like to, if you can, briefly just run over the options for me one more time.
Okay. The first option, and this was back in the October meeting, the first option was status quo. Leave it the way it is. Don't do anything. Let the contract renew. And in that, there's an increase in the rate built into the contract of 2%. So the contract would go up to $157,255. The rate in the township would remain at 4.5 cents, and the EMS units would continue to respond to that area from inside the city where they currently are. So that's status quo. At that time, there was also the piece from the county provided all of it, was that you not renew the contract, the county provide a paramedic unit located in the township, that you increase the rate to the maximum of five cents, which you've done in some other areas, and that you bill for services and use those revenues to offset those costs. And with that anticipated revenue and the taxes that would come out of the district, we're projecting that there's about $121,000 you would need out of fund balance to make up that difference. There was a third option in October that was, the concern was that right now, and nobody's disputing the fact, and it's just the way it is, that right now the city is staffed to fight fire, and they provide EMS because they have firemen and fire ladies, women, firefighters, excuse me, who can do that. They're paramedics, they're intermediates, they can do those things. So they're staffed to fight fire and to maintain their ISO rating and maybe even decrease that ISO rating. And they do EMS because they can do that. The problem occurs in the concern that was expressed was their units are not able to leave the city because they've got to be local to fight fire when a fire call comes out. So they can't, if we need to move units around, they're not able to say, okay, we'll take our ambulance and move it over to Chocowini when there's nothing on the south side open. You know, we can't do that because our guys have to be here, because if we're not here, then ISO could ding us and we could get in a lot of trouble. And that, you know, everybody understands that. The other piece of it is, if they get a fire call, then those units go to the fire call. I mean, they, you know, one of them, the majority of them, I think both of them, but at least one of them is engaged in firefighting, not EMS provision, and the other one either provides EMS as a standby unit on scene or maybe even providing firefighting coverage. So the concern was that if you have that, you lose complete coverage within the city, and with that, you also lose it in the district that you're contracting for. So the third option at that time was to say, tell us what it would take to have a dedicated unit that would not have to be engaged in firefighting if a call came out. The city went back and looked at those numbers, and they came back and said that cost would be about $572,000 to do that. That unit would then be available. It could move around as needed, and it wouldn't be tied to fighting fire. It would still be located in the city and would respond out like the existing contract does, but it would be available to move around, and if there was a big fire in town and all the units were out, they would still be available for EMS calls. And then the fourth option that was kind of a conglomeration of the two, based upon the concerns that were expressed, was to say, let's put a QRV out there so that we can reach out in the long areas of the district, because, you know, the district goes all the way to Martin County and goes to Pitt County and then runs up 171. For us to put a QRV out there so that we get a quick response while the ambulance is still coming out of Washington or coming from wherever it has to come from to provide transport services. We could not do that just on our own with just a QRV, because you've got to have transport capabilities. We can't transport in a QRV. So you still got to have some transport capability coming in to back that up. That's why the proposal on the fourth proposal was to maintain the contract with the city, because somebody's got to transport. In that discussion, again, we talked about our understanding was that the board was committed to $121,000, didn't think you would commit any more than that, so we set it at $121,000, which would reduce the contract side from the city. So those are the four pieces that were laid out there.
Yes.
I don't know if I should direct to Commissioner Evans or Stally. Was there any discussion on the county providing a full equipped vehicle in Old Ford and Washington maintaining Clark's Neck area?
No.
That hadn't been brought up. That wasn't one of the alternatives that were posed by the committee or by anybody from the city.
Mr. Chairman, I have a motion. The most economical thing to do, and what I think the people in Washington Township and the Old Ford area want, the service area, is to maintain the status quo. They are satisfied with that. That is the most economical thing to do also. That's a motion.
Okay. You heard the motion. Is there a second to Commissioner Richardson's motion? I hear none. So the motion dies. And so our vote in October stands.
Can I ask one more?
Yes.
Question?
Yes.
Would it be worthwhile us having that discussion based on the question I asked?
Based on what?
About us supplying a full service vehicle and the city taking care of Clark's Neck. Does that make sense at all?
The costs are going to be the same because you're not reducing personnel.
I think think the concern that you'll hear, I think you got the same concern. The areas inside, the concern as I understood it from folks who live close to the city, they're in the Old Ford District. There are some in the Clark Snack District, but there are also folks in the Old Ford District.
I was just raising it as, you know, as a possible option, but.
Unless you can find a way to cut staff, and I don't think you can. You can't go to half people and third people.
I mean, we're happy to look at anything you'd like for us to look at. But again, you know, we, in fairness to the city and fairness to our budget making process, I don't want to rush an issue, but there is a time limit on what you want to do. I think you've got. You still do have some time, but once you hit that 90-day mark,
thank you, Mr. Chairman.
It automatically rolls over.
Just for the public record, we have 3 quick response units in the county currently. Is that right?
24 hours and then operation.
So we actually have 3. The thing about the quick response unit is we're not able to bill for those vehicles. The only thing that we can bill for is the full service, what I call the full service truck. Going back to the consultant's presentation to us, we made a commitment over time to go to countywide paramedic service. We also made a commitment to go to countywide billing. And we also made a commitment to, at some point in time, having a county-wide tax that's equal all across the county. I think that what we're doing is, over time, we're trying to follow the recommendation that the consultant has. So does any other commissioner have any comment? If not, Katie, you're next.
Ms. Smith is wanting to revamp up the water committee in Beaufort County. It's been dormant for about 2 years now. One of the chairs was vacated by Commissioner Belcher, and we are looking to fill that position within
our committee. Okay, and I think that we still have 2 people on there. That's Commissioner Langley and Commissioner Brin.
She's hoping to meet quarterly.
Okay. I reached out to Commissioner Evans, and he agreed that he would be willing to serve on that, so I'll make that a motion.
Second.
Is there a second?
Yeah,
second?
You got it.
By Commissioner Booth. All those in favor, raise your right hand.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everybody vote?
Yes.
All right. 7-0. We're down to our closed session. And I'll ask Katie to read us into closed session.
Motion is needed to go into closed session for a personnel issue under North Carolina Statute 143-318-11A6 to consider the qualifications, competence, performance condition, and appointment of a public officer or employee or prospective public officer or employee. Also to go into closed session under NCGS 143-318-11A3 to consult with an attorney employed or retained by the public body in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the attorney and the public body.
Can I have a motion to go into closed session?
I moved.
Motion by Commissioner Brand.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Booth. All those in favor, raise your right hand. 7-0. Okay, we're coming out of closed session, and there was no action, or there'll be no actions taken. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Got a motion to adjourn. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor, raise your right hand.